You know, there's some people say, well, you know, if God is real and if he's in existence, then why doesn't he reveal himself? He does. He does, but he has to have people who are willing to agree with him and believe him, that who are willing to stand in his place and command devils to go out, command the sick and the diseased to be healed, command the moon and the sun to stand still in their place if need be, as it was in the days of Joshua. He just needs those who will stand still. I mean, if he didn't have a Moses who would stand still and see my salvation, God, Moses said, what am I going to do now? We're up against it. We got the sea in front of us here, and we got the armies of Pharaoh to our back. If he didn't have a Moses who would be willing to stand still and see the salvation, and then just take and lift up this rod, stretch forth his rod, his power and his glory would not have been made known. God made man in his image and his likeness really in the very beginning as already a co-inheritor with him, as a partner with him. And just because Adam decided that he was going to do his own thing didn't change God's covenant relationship that he had already established, that we come to more understand now in Christ Jesus. This isn't a new plan. This is the plan. All that the Lord did was set the plan back on track, and that's why Paul said to the church at Ephesus, he chose us from the beginning to be with him and in him, holy and without blame before him all the days of our life. That's who we're supposed to be. That's how we're supposed to function. And what happens is we turn our hearts to all the things that would consume us based upon our culture. If you lived 1,000 years ago, you'd be dancing a different tune to the world, because you would have a different culture, you'd have a different social structure, and all you'd be doing, you'd be dressed different, but you'd be dancing, you'd be the same person, but you'd be just dancing a different tune. Now you're caught now here in the 21st century, faced with the same challenges that people had 1,000 years ago, really. Nothing's really changed. In the spiritual dynamic of things, nothing's really changed. And reality of it is we're so consumed with the things that we're that is dictated to us by our sociology, that it produces all of this doubt and all this unbelief and all this inappropriate response to circumstances around us and little response to heaven. So Father brings us over into a place and he says, I want you to walk by faith and not by sight. I want you to live by my word, which will produce faith in you. I want you to live by my word at the expense of having to reject and deny evidence and facts and the sensory dimension of man, especially the sight and touch. The sight and touch of man does more to man than any other two senses. The sight, the touch, and the sound. Boy, that is really overwhelming. And now the Lord says, I want you to look on things which are unseen, not which things that are seen. I'm going to give you the ability to look on the unseen because I'm going to give you faith, which is the evidence of the unseen. I'm going to give you faith. I'm going to give you a realm of faith. I'm going to give you a realm of faith, a supernatural development. See, people misdefine faith. They just think it's your beliefs. It's not your religious beliefs. Faith is a supernatural ability that God gives us simply because we're willing to live by his word. You listen to me, because you're not going to get it if you don't listen by the Spirit. Faith is the supernatural ability to live out God's life right now simply because we're willing to obey the word. If you're not willing to obey the word and do the word, if you're not willing to put the word above all other things, faith will not work. The word is going to literally run contrary to everything that you see. The majority of the time. Say majority. Say like 99.99%. Say most of the time, I'm going to have to go with the word. And it's going to be contrary to everything that I see. Now let's elevate it. All of the time, I'm going to have to go with the word of God. That's going to be contrary to everything that I see. It's going to be contrary to the things that people have said about me, that I said about me, that I believe about me, that others believe about me. You listen to me now, because otherwise you're stuck forever. You can't stand and sit in meetings like this and not respond to the Word of God and listen to the Word of God and be healthy, because my goodness, the same fire and the same glory that melts the wax hardens the clay. And I'm telling you, that fire and that glory is here. Hallelujah. And you just want to take a hold of these things and recognize, wait a minute, God's called me to live by His Word. This is the word of faith, which is in my heart and in my mouth, which He's placed within my heart because He gave me a new heart and wrote upon my heart His Word. And so I want you just go ahead and be seated for a while and just talk to you a little bit, because I want to try to bring things together for you. If you weren't here on Sunday night, I want to encourage you to get the tape, to get actually look at the YouTube, because it's one of the most important messages that you can possibly understand, that you can possibly hear. You need to hear it over and over again. Of course, God would deliver it to us in so many different ways, and it's really all about having, about understanding how to be fit and equipped to deal with temptation. You got to be fit and equipped. If you're not, you're going to get blown away every single time. And thus, the popular consensus is that man has to sin every day, that man has got to live an earthly human existence. He can't take on the image of Christ Jesus. And it's all anti-Christ and it's all anti-gospel when you distill it down to its inconclusion, to its final result. It's definitely not even biblical orthodoxy. Most people would not even articulate in words primarily what it is that they practice. Because if they articulated in words what they practice, then their words would tell them, wait a minute, this is not even in the Bible. This is not even what God said. This is certainly has nothing to do with foundational doctrines of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we kind of hide in the illusion that we're doing things right because we say things right, but in reality, the practice is by and large very, very wrong. And fundamentally, the Lord took Israel as the general, as the great, He's the greatest general ever has ever existed. He's it. And He took the nation of Israel out of slavery, and He led them into the wilderness. He led them into one trial, one examination, after another evaluation. Those are all synonyms: tribulation, temptation, trial, evaluation, examination. Okay? And the bottom line of it is, hey, we rejoice having received the end of our faith, the saving of our soul. But if need be, many people are in many different types of trials, that the trying of their faith, which is much more precious than gold, might be, though it perishes, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Christ Jesus. And that's Peter's declaration in 1 Peter chapter 1. You got to understand this, dear people. You and I are faced every day with temptation, with an opposition of the one who's called our adversary. In the Hebrew language, adversary is Satan. And Satan is where we get the word Satan. And it means adversary. Your adversary, the devil, Peter says, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him steadfast in the faith. But you got to understand, if you're not willing to walk by the word of God, you're not in the faith. If you're not willing to understand how that the word of God can abide in you, and that because the word of God abides in you, you strong and have defeated Satan at every point or overcome the wicked one. You understand? Are you listening to me? I write unto you, young men, because you're strong, the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Okay? Jesus writes over and again in his address to seven churches in Revelation chapter 2 through 3, he writes to the overcomer. There is simply no description and witness of the new birth and the born-again believer like the description of no longer being overwhelmed by sin, but having authority over all the powers of darkness, to tread upon all the powers of darkness, that nothing can by any means hurt you, to tread over scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, as Jesus said to the disciples in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. So, and then of course, John really distills it down, and he helps us to understand, that if you sin, he said, don't let anybody deceive you. If you sin, you're of the devil. If you do righteousness, you're of God. He says it over and over again. Now, people don't want to recognize that because all of a sudden, you've got to make a transition from religion to relationship. You've got to make a transition wherein you understand now how to be continually filled with the Spirit. So Paul, that's why Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5, he says, don't be fools. Literally says, don't be fools. I know King James said, don't be unwise. But he said, don't be fools. People think, oh, you're not supposed to pull out the fool word. But Jesus called his disciples fools. He said, oh, fools and slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. And, you know, there's a lot of foolish behavior. The most intense foolish behavior, the person that is most void of understanding, are those who will not give heed unto the word of God. I mean, you know, the word of God is wisdom, it's insight, and if you've got it right there before you, and now you've been born of the incorruptible seed by the word of God, which lives and abides forever, and you're going to ignore the word of God and just go with whatever it is that you want, whatever it is you believe, you're going to go with the wind of circumstance, you're going to go with the storms of situations around you and opposing trials and adversarial things, then you're just unwise, and you're going to fall, and you're going to collapse, and it's going to be proof that you're not built upon the word Christ Jesus. You're not built upon the rock. Your house is going to collapse, and you got an evidence. Wait a minute, man. I wasn't able to stand in the evil day. I was not able to endure temptation. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for after that he has tried, examined, evaluated. He shall receive a crown of life, which fades not away. People want to completely take that away. They say, oh, no, you don't understand. You don't understand grace. I love it when, you know, it's, I love when people say that because by and large, it's like the guy who comes in as a freshman in college and he's telling everybody that they don't really understand the mechanism of chemistry. You know, it's just like, okay, you know, they got a great, unique understanding. They got this insight that nobody else in the world's got. Grace. We don't understand grace. Jesus is grace. He's the fullness of grace. He's brought everything that is grace to us. He's the package of grace. And he said, come follow me. He said things like, deny yourself, take up your cross, and come follow me. And people try to put that within the context of a religious practice, and it ain't going to work. You're not going to live out his life like that. It's a relationship. The Lord gives to us an empowerment and a privilege and ability to understand what his will is. Jesus said, not everyone who calls upon me, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord. And when you have, in the Greek language, when you have a doublet of words like Lord, Lord, and even also in the Hebrew language, it is an emphasis that says, he's absolutely my Lord. He's definitely my Lord. So really, that's how King James translated, most translations translated that particular pericope is that in that way, but that isn't really what it means. It means he's absolutely my Lord. Not everyone who says he's absolutely my Lord is coming into the kingdom. He said, rather those who do the will of the Father. So anytime we see doing the will of the Father, this is the will of the Father. It's very, very important. You know, we understand that if we're going to effectively deal with demonic powers, the adversary, you know, the name of Satan isn't really known, just his deeds. He's known by his deeds. Adversary. I know in the Latinized form of his Old Testament name is revealed in Isaiah 14, it's Lucifer, the Shining One. But nonetheless, we don't know what his name is. God blots out the name of the wicked, and I don't want to know what his name is. But his adversary. Devil is just simply means, in both in the Hebrew language and the Greek language, slanderer. You look in Revelation chapter 12, and we discover that he's the one who accuses, slanders, night and day. Who's he slandering? You and me? I mean, he's a rebellious imp. He does not believe that he's been defeated. You can say he's been defeated all you want. He's in your face. He doesn't believe he's been defeated. He's going to come up against the armies of the Lord, as we talk about, and people really got a lot of interesting things to say about this these days, about the Battle of Armageddon, what's going to happen there when Satan comes down is cast down out of heaven, for there's no more place for him there, Revelation chapter 12, and we see the armies of man mobilized by him, and he comes up and brings men by his works of deception to fight against God. I mean, you talk about, you know, you talk about a level of deception that is hard even maybe it's even impossible to comprehend. I think we're being able to comprehend it more now because we've raised a generation now that is about 5 or 6 years old that are anti-God, anti-religion, anti-church, anti-United States of America. Watch what they're coming up to be, because what's happened is through the agenda that has been propagated that God has allowed in the United States of America, things are gone amiss big time. But the bottom line of it is, I mean, think about Satan. He deceived, and most people want to say it this way, and I think it's an appropriate way to say it, although it's only one verse of Scripture that reveals it. We have to be very careful with it. 1/3 of the angels. But nonetheless, that's without, in the absence of anything else, it's okay to say that. 1/3 of the angels. Now, we're talking about these mighty heavenly creatures, this creation that stood before the Father beholding his glory. Think about this with me. Stood in his presence for ages and ages. Who knows? Billions of years. I don't know. Trillions of years. And he was able to deceive them? What do you think he could do to me? What do you think he can do to you? I mean, people just play around. They play these little hokey-pokey games. And they call it, this is the power and the authority of sonship. It isn't the power and the authority of sonship. The power and the authority of sonship is revealed in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, where Paul says, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. But whoa. Time out. That's a whole lot of power. How can you go wrong? How can you miss? How can you be defeated? How can you be overcome? How can you be conquered for a moment? Being strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. You can't. He says that you may take unto yourself the whole armor of God. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and rulers and spiritual wickedness in high places. Now, I'm going to just ask you a simple question. How well is God doing against everything Satan's doing? You know, how effective is Jesus? He was very effective, never sinned one single time. He was tried, he was evaluated, he was examined. Every time he stood in the Word of God, in the great evaluation of the temptation that lasted for 40 days in the wilderness, right after that the power of God came upon him and he was identified by his cousin John, that he was the Messiah because the Holy Ghost came upon him and remained. He was driven by the Holy Ghost into the wilderness and was tested, tried, evaluated, examined for 40 days as the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. This is the first examination, no spot, no blemish. And then the third year examination that takes place 3 years later, no spot, no blemish, Passover sacrifice. And so we can understand exactly the authority of Christ Jesus. Hasse pecata moshiparotaya. And, you know, when we look at Peter, what he has to say in 2 Peter chapter 1, he says, God has given you everything you need. He's given you everything that pertains to life and godliness. He's given you everything. By his divine power, he's given you everything that you need that pertains to life and godliness, because he's called you to glory and excellence of character or virtue. So men are without excuse. Verse 4, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, because you've been made partaker of the divine nature, because you've been made one with him, not absent from him, not different from him, not transcendent from him. You are one with him, union with him. You don't exist outside of him. Uh-oh. This is the crisis point, because we got a whole lot of existence outside of him. But God's called us to come over to be conformed to the image of the Son. God's called us to come over, live in the Holy Ghost, walk in the Holy Ghost, be led by the Holy Ghost. If you walk in the Spirit, you should not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh and the lust thereof. I mean, it's over and over and over, hundreds upon hundreds of verses of Scripture that is the highlights of thousands and thousands of Scripture concerning God's will and purpose for mankind. And we're walking around with our ears plugged up, wondering why we can't do what Father has said for us to do. Thus, we redefine his word for our time. God says, don't be a fool, but be wise. Amen. Understanding what the will of the Lord is, what the will of the Father is. Amen. Very important little phrase. Yes. Don't be drunk with wine wherein is excess. Hallelujah. Well, actually, that's a King James derivation. Wherein is debauchery? wherein is all kinds of excess immorality, but be filled with the Spirit. Here we have a sign on the highway in California that says, if you're driving buzz, you're driving drunk. If you are buzzer, you are drunker. You know what I'm saying? Get a clue. The ungodly have more discernment than supposedly the house of the Lord. I'm just buzzed. Oh, I don't get drunk. Oh, I just sip. Oh, whatever. My goodness gracious. You liar. You know what I'm saying? And you don't know how to be filled with the Spirit. Therefore, you're going to have a Romans chapter 7 concept of salvation, where I find no good thing in me. I got Christ Jesus in me. I got the greater one on the inside of me. He's greater than he is in the world. I don't know what on earth you're talking about. God's called us out to live in a realm called heaven. He's called us to be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. And in the Greek language, is to be continually filled with the Spirit. And not only is it there by the verb form that exists in, but it's also there by context, because it says singing and hymns and psalms and singing spiritual songs. Singing will make a melody in your heart unto God. Hallelujah. But, you know, that's always going to be challenged, because there's always this press against us to be conformed to the world. Worldliness is something that has been adopted as acceptable in this dimension of grace. All things are lawful. You can murder, rape, kill, fornicate, adultery, blaspheme. Everything's lawful. That's not. That's just twisting the word, wrestling it to your own destruction, because Paul's talking about kosher food. What you can eat, it's all lawful. Rise, kill, and eat. It is amazing how ridiculous people can be in a place called blindness of heart and mind. Deception has no reason. So you lost the ability to logically think, to rationalize. However, the grace of God that brings salvation has taught us to deny ungodliness and all worldly lust, all worldliness, to now go after a righteousness, come on, to live righteously, to live righteously, amen, to live godly in this present world. Titus 11, 12. Titus, forgive me, 2, 11 and 12. Okay? Paul goes on in chapter 3 to describe or define salvation as he's defined over and over again in so many terms. And he defines it in such a wonderful way in Titus chapter 3. He says, being saved, being delivered by the washing of the water of regeneration. There's the new creation. There's the new birth. That any man be in Christ Jesus, a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things are new. A washing of water, regeneration. I got a new genes, man. I got his mighty blood now flows through my veins. That's what great-grandpa used to sing. Southern Baptist Pentecostal preacher. His royal blood now flows through my veins. I mean, come on. We've lost that whole concept of oneness with God. We've lost the concept of the reality of what Jesus described when he said, Father, the glory you gave to me, I gave it to them. So that they could be one, just like you and me are one. So that as you are in me, I am in them and they are in me. He declares to us this manifest glory. They want to take John 17, 21 through 23 and talk to us about how somehow we are getting together to be one. It's this big ecumenical thing going down. It's nonsense. He's not even talking about that. He's talking about oneness. He's talking about his oneness with the Father. It's how you hearken back to what he was saying in John 14, 11. He said, if you don't believe my words, believe me for my work's sake. It's not me that does the work. It's my Father, which is in me. He does the works. And anybody who believes on me, these same works shall he do. And these greater works, because the Father's going to dwell in them too. Now, you know I added that last part, because the Father's going to dwell on them too. But that's actually what is implied. And then he says it, doesn't he? By the time you hit verse 24, if you love me, keep my commandments, keep my words, keep my saying. The Ten Commandments is described as the Decalogue, which literally means Decalogue, Latin, 10 words. His words, commandments, same thing. His sayings, his words, his commandments. So he said, you obey me, you just keep my words. If you love me, this is the, you know, is somebody says God has a theocracy. It's something far greater than a theocracy. It's rulership by relationship. If you love me, you will obey me. You'll do what I say. And if you'll obey me, my Father will love you. People go, wait a minute. I thought he already loved us. No. He loves the world, but he hasn't got a relationship with them. It's a relationship love. My Father will love you. And we'll come and make our dwelling with you. My Father will come. I'll manifest myself to you. My Father's going to go. Papa, listen to me. Yeah. I mean, just think about it. I got a river of divine power and glory. The veil of the temple was rent. The holies of the holies moved from the temple made by hands into the temples of those that redeemed with a new heart, a new spirit. So that as God said by his servant Ezekiel, a new covenant has been established. A new heart and new spirit I give you. You got to start thinking about yourself differently. And I put my Holy Spirit on the inside of you. And I'm going to put my Holy Spirit, and they had no idea that there would be an expression and a fulgency of God's divine power gushing out of us on the scale of rivers, like where there's this great river in Zambia, the Zambezi, that flows over into Victoria Falls. And it's like Victoria Falls and Niagara Falls converging, coming out of me. My wife and I were standing at the Zambezi last month, you know, and I'm just like standing, we got right in the middle of the Zambezi where the big splash comes because it's right now, you know, it was last month, it was the big, huh? What, baby? So it's just, whatever. But at any rate, we were just getting splashed by the, because it's the time where the water is just really rushing strong, you know. And I'm like, we're standing there going, man, that's what's coming out of me right now. This is the dimension of the power and the glory of God. However, we have a real hard time believing that. You know why? Because we look in the mirror. And the sense realm takes over. And now we walk by sight, not by faith. And we evaluate ourselves because we know ourselves out of the flesh. We don't know ourselves out of the spirit yet. But you better start knowing yourself out of the spirit if you want to get from babyhood into something more. If you want to move out of that carnality that Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 to the church at Corinth, they were doing good. In fact, I think in many ways he did a lot better than the modern day church. They were doing great. I mean, they had all the gifts. They had all the signs. They had all the wonders. They had every good thing going on in the midst of the church. That would be full-blown Holy Ghost, unmeasurable, intense, like unprecedented revival if we were having a church doing what the church at Corinth did. You know what I'm saying? Just go read it again. Huh. And he said, you're carnal. One says I'm of Apollos. It'd be cool to be of Apollos. Apollos was a powerful prophet. I'm of Cephas, Peter. Wow. I mean, that's another great one. Some say, Paul, great men follow. He said, you guys are just, you're totally missing it. And then ultimately goes on to help them understand. We don't even know Jesus after the flesh anymore. We know him after the spirit. We don't know any man after the flesh anymore. It's not about all of that. All we are is these mouthpieces declaring these spirits made spirit by God who is spirit to declare to you how you can step over in this realm of divine oneness and glory and this overwhelming flood of heaven filling every dimension of your life.
If I
could just help you to start walking by faith instead of by sight. To no longer look on those things which are seen. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4:18, no longer looking on those things which are seen, no longer responding to, no longer valuing. Father, you just expect way too much of us. He said, be filled with the Spirit. Have the mind of the Spirit. The spiritual mind. Hallelujah. We no longer think after the natural. We think after the realms of the Spirit, after the realms of the Holy Ghost, after the realms of a spiritual unseen realm. No longer responding to that which is seen, but we look on those things which are unseen. We look unto the one, the author and finisher of our faith. We live by the Word of God, which is, as it were, you know, a periscope into the unseen realm. Now what am I supposed to do, God?
Speak to the mountain. Tell it, get out of your way. Okay, mountain, out of my way. It's done. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We were recently we were in a little country town, urban country town, out in the middle of nowhere. And there's a young girl, just totally disease-ridden, with Lyme's disease, all messed up. And we looked at her, and I said, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, from this day forward, that disease has no more place in your body. See, I have received from Father authority and power to be a son of God. You have too. The only difference that might exist between you and me is I believe it and appropriate it more. I'm more radical about it. I'm more passionate about it. You can't talk me out of it. A situation can't talk me out of it. Failure can't, or seeming failure can't talk me out of it. Nothing can talk me out of it. I got a mindset. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Karabasetereya. You know, I look at Donald Trump, and he's just such an eccentric, you know, and the guy, it's just hard to even listen to, right? But all he is a personification of a mindset. It's just a mindset. If you in the earthly realm, if people just have a mindset, many people don't do anything because of mindset. You just look, migrant workers, and I love migrant workers. You know, come on, don't take me wrong. They work hard. Migrant workers. Okay, we'll go with migrant workers. Migrant workers are going to do what Grandpa did. They're going to do strawberries. They're going to do the harvesting of fruit. They're going to work for wages that are just absolutely pathetic. It's worthless. It's unbelievable. Now, somebody sitting down in South America says, if I can only get to America, I'll get rich. He doesn't have grandpa and great-grandpa telling, imposing upon him that he can only be a migrant worker. He's got a mindset. This is just in the human realm. This is just human realm. He's got this mindset. Huh? If I can just get to America, I'll be wealthy. He gets to America, he's wealthy. Has maybe even less ability than the migrant worker did. Has less chance, less understanding of the culture than the migrant worker did, but an entirely different mindset. God wants us to have a different mindset. We have a real problem with this. He says, don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured by thinking different about yourself, having a different mindset. What we want to do is we want to go with the King James translation says, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. What on earth does that mean? What on earth does that mean? We're talking about Greek languages, which is street Greek. It's lay Greek. It's for the common, everyday worker Greek. It simply means stop thinking like you've been thinking and think different. Start thinking different. Think what God told you to think. Think by what God's word describes you to be. Big part of this whole thing. That's why the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty, and it's really focused down on the way you think. We listen to some evil report, some logical discussion, and all of a sudden our whole attention, our mind, our thinking realm is turned to that, and we're going, yeah. I mean, most people are not spiritually strong enough to watch CNN. They're not spiritually strong enough to watch Fox News because they think all that stuff is the truth. And now they're thinking that way. Yeah, I mean, here we have been trying to get into Cuba for a massive evangelism crusade in Havana, huh? Because we got Kingdom of God on our mind. All of a sudden, Obama opens up the door for the first time, and everybody's screaming, he's betrayed America! We're going, woo, praise God! It's a different mindset. It's coming at things from a different report, a different perspective. Are you going to be earthly? Are you going to be heavenly? Are you going to live in the realms of men's information or what God's declared to be? I'm telling you, we understand by faith. He formed the ages. He formed the worlds, the cosmos by his word. His word's powerful. It's spirit. It's life. It's living. It's powerful. It's sharper. It's a sword of the Spirit that will take off heads. It'll take off every giant. I guarantee you, David didn't move in his own human effort and religious ideology. The same Spirit of the Lord came upon him. It came upon him to as we began to sing psalms and hymns. He didn't do the spiritual songs. That wasn't available yet. Belongs to the enemy here.
this age, this time. That wasn't available to him at that time. But that glory that caused him to be the sweet psalmist of Israel, that caused that anointed that made him so bold that he grabbed a hold of the lion and killed the lion and took the bear as though the bear was a teddy bear and destroyed it. Same anointing came upon him. He looked down and he said, I'm taking your head from off your shoulders. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. I'm taking your head from off your shoulders. This day I shall give your flesh to the beasts of the field and to the fowls of the air. I come not with sword or shield, but by the name and authority, the authority of the living God. The Most High, El Elohim Yehovah, the Most High God. Hallelujah. Mazedei Yeshua. Okay, different thinking. Same crisis. Same experience, same situation, different setting. Huh? Second, you know, 2,000-3,000 years ago that took place. Nothing's different. Same opportunity. In fact, greater opportunity, greater anointing, greater authority, sonship authority. When you read Romans chapter 8 and you begin to understand that Romans chapter 8 speaks of the Holy Ghost more than any single chapter in the Bible, in the New Testament, but also in the Bible. 20 times. Laying out the spiritual laws of life, laying out for us the understanding of how to function and flow and mature in this wonderful realm of sonship that all creation groaned and travailed, waiting to see this manifestation of these who walk in the Spirit, who are led by the Spirit, who have the mind of the Spirit, hallelujah, who don't walk in the flesh, for we're not in the flesh but in the Spirit. I'm not an earthly being, I'm a heavenly one, hallelujah. I bore the image of the earthly, but now I bear the image of the heavenly, being conformed to the image of Christ Jesus in all things. Because that's the command. You didn't know it. I'm just quoting Scripture. I'm weaving Scripture together. If I spend the time, look up all the verses of Scripture or reference all the verses of Scripture, I won't get everything said that I need to say. Okay? If you want them, it's going to be on YouTube. You can look them all up. If I stopped, I could shut down and just start quoting verses of Scripture to you if that would really help you. But I'm going to tell you right now, I know for truth, which is higher than fact, that the Word of God will not return void. It's going into you. And yes. If you just grab it with your spirit, yes. If you just grab it with your spirit, you see, you can just all of a sudden, something starts welling up on the inside of you. Whoo, can these things be true? Huh? Can everything about my life begin to change right now? Can I grab a hold of these things with my spirit and all of a sudden it begin to produce within my life the very life of God, the very manifestation of Christ Jesus, so that we could say that Christ Jesus is fully revealed in our life. Paul said, I fully preached the gospel from Jerusalem to Illyricum with mighty signs and wonders and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. That's what God's purpose for you and me to do. He's given us all authority. Jesus said, all authority is given unto me in heaven and earth. Watch my grandbabies. My grandbaby's going to walk in all the authority. Why? Because mama and daddy, grandfather, great-grandfather, and great-great-grandfather's dead now. Everybody's full of the Holy Ghost. What happens when you have legacy to great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grand? You don't have to. You can be the first in your whole family history that's walked with God, and you can step into this. But I'm going to tell you right now. My seed shall walk in these things. Because my daddy said it, my mama said it, my mama's grandparents were preachers, my daddy's parents were preachers, their parents were preachers, and their parents were preachers, and it's just in my blood. And everybody's been prophesying, and my kid will walk in, and my children shall walk in, and my seed shall possess the nations, and shall be great in the presence of the Lord, and shall live before him. Come on, and just start prophesying over yourself. Start prophesying over your family. Get rid of all of the caste system. America has a caste system as much as India says has a caste system. We say we don't. We do. We have a caste system. What grade you go to? That's how much money you're going to make because these are jobs you're going to work. You know, sixth grade? Okay, this is what you're going to do. 12th grade? Okay, this is what you're going to do. Oh, 4 years of college? Okay, this is what you're going to do. Oh, you got a master's degree? Okay, this is what you can do. PhD? Okay, you can do this. And there's all of these caste systems. It's based upon, by and large, academics, to some degree, color of skin. Various different things that people gravitate towards, especially people who have the privilege to supposedly to make the rules. However, I know the one who makes the absolute rules. She said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. So I discount all of that. I move right past it. Ha! Doesn't count. Can't affect me. Can't influence me.
You cannot place anything or limits on me. I have an unlimited realm of impossibility. Is anything impossible for me? And you know, when the Lord's talking to Abraham, he says, is there, you know, King James says, is there anything too difficult for me? Isn't that what the King James says? He says, too hard for me, right? He says, is there anything too hard? Yehovah says, is there anything too hard for me? He says, is there anything too difficult for my word? That's a literal translation. Is there anything difficult, too difficult for my word? The word is davar. Davar. Davar is a noun that literally is word. It means word. Davar. Okay? It's not anything. You can't translate anything. You could translate anything if it was perhaps in the PL form, like dever. But davar, it's just word. I don't know why some of these translators believe that they need to make it more understandable to us. Quit trying so hard. Just give me the word. Just give me the word. I like the word. Is anything too hard for my word? No. You speak the word and it shall be done. This is faith. That's what the centurion said. He had no right to Jesus. He was a Gentile. He had no right to the covenants. He had no right to the promises. Jesus said himself, I'm not sent but to the lost house of Israel. Huh? Here comes a centurion who believes. I mean, you talk about people with an identity weirdness going on. The Romans believed they were superior to all races, and it lasted for 600 years of intense domination, especially 400 years. The last 200 years is pretty weak. Everybody, they made slaves out of everybody. Everybody was conformed or killed. And here's a centurion. He says, wait a minute, speak the word only. I'm not worthy that you should come in my house. Boy, the table is turned. Hey, he's seeing another realm. He's seeing another dimension. Come on, could you see another realm? Could you see another dimension? Would you start living by the word? Would you start walking in the spirit? Would you allow God to show you everything from a heavenly perspective instead of an earthly one? You got to be retrained. You got to be re-educated. I hope you're in a re-education camp tonight. I hope you get brainwashed tonight with the water of the word. I was brainwashed by my mother. Hallelujah. You know, I have two of my sisters sitting in here, Geneva and Faith back there. We are brainwashed by our mother. I mean, before we could say mom and daddy, we could say John 3:16. And then right after that was, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my strength and my redeemer. I mean, you know, you wake up in the middle of the night, that's what she dreamed about, because she'd say it over and again. The word of God washes us, causes us to think different. You can do anything. Nothing is impossible for you. You have his ministry. He's given you the nations for your inheritance. The uttermost parts of the earth are your possession. He's put you in charge. You're heir of God. You're heir of God. Co-inheritor with Jesus. You're a son. Co-inheritors with Jesus. All authority is given to me in heaven and earth. Go make disciples out of nations. Well, we believe that all your authority is up there in heaven. We having a hard time on earth. I mean, I'm telling you. We were on the 47th floor in Tokyo. And I mean, talking about it, it's a free society. Tokyo is a free, Japan is a free society, a republic. And it's the most, probably the most unreached people groups, nation that I've ever been in. You know, and we're doing, you know, we're doing a 5 crusades, 5 different cities. And it was towards the end back in Tokyo, and I'm going, Lord, you look really small here. You look really teeny tiny. And Satan looks like the master of the world. I mean, you got all these tall buildings and the churches. I mean, in the greatest city on the planet, Tokyo, Japan, 25, 26 million people. And there's about 1,000 churches that average 30 people in size. And that's the way it is in every big city, because we were in every big city. And I woke up, the Lord woke me up that next morning. I mean, I was just I was going after it. Father, what is it going to take? What does it take for me to step past the veil of doubt and unbelief? What does it take for your church to go back and enter into the faith as once delivered unto the saints? And at 5 o'clock in the morning, the Spirit of the Lord, Christ Jesus, spoke to me. Every time the Lord speaks to me, he just quotes the word to me. He said to me, Mark, said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. I'm just looking for somebody to agree. The agreement is the problem here. Because we're so distracted, we're so consumed by all these things that occupy us, all these things that place demand upon us. And the more we entangle ourselves with the affairs of this life, and the more we entangle ourselves with the cares of this life, and the more we entangle ourselves with the world, the more we have oppressing spirits of doubt and unbelief that becomes, as it were, blinders, a veil over our face, so that we can not look steadfastly into the glory. And really, you know, I'm trying my best to bring together some of the things that the Holy Ghost has been saying the past couple of meetings. I'm trying to help you understand how to get fit and equipped to deal with the things that Satan's trying to do to disqualify you, that the slanderer is trying to do to stop you. Because the more place you give him, the more right he has to condemn you, even in your own mind, not just before the presence of the Lord. And being able to understand how that they that are in Christ Jesus, that there's no more condemnation. There's therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life, or the spiritual laws of life in Christ Jesus, have made us free from the law of sin and death. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. Mambrusataya. What God has done by sending his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, condemned sin in the flesh, that you and I might be made the righteousness of God if we're willing to believe something different, if we're willing to step into the authority of sonship. He looks at us in John 1:12, you know, in the context of who he is, of his fullness have all we received in grace for grace. Powerful, eh? Of his fullness? How about his halfness? I feel better like, you know, somebody said, we're junior Christ. Look, the people, we don't exist outside of him. We live and move and have our being in him. Our whole existence is in him. There's got to be a change. You look at your grandpa or your great-grandfather and you begin to define your existence. Forget about it. I can a little bit better happily because mine are preachers, Holy Ghost people, ambulance chasers. My great-grandfather was ambulance chaser. He was not a lawyer. He was a preacher. He wanted to raise people from the dead, whatever disease, sickness, whatever problem was. He wanted to get to them before the doctors got their hands on him. Before the doctors got their greasy fingers on him, he wanted to get after him. Amen. No offense, doc. Hey? Just knowing our authority. Jesus said, in this context, he said, anybody who's going to believe and receive, I'll give you authority to be sons. Sonship. Sonship is highlighted, brings us to a great position of divine authority by the time Paul talks about it and breaks it down in Galatians chapter 4. He breaks it down. He leaves us with no wiggle room to wonder what on earth God's talking about. He says, as long as you're a child, you differ nothing than a servant, though you be Lord of all, but are under tutors and governors until the appointed time. The appointed time. But now, the appointed time is sonship. And he's talking about stepping almost instantaneously, even as a babe in Christ, immediately into sonship. So that Jesus would say, John the Baptist is the greatest prophet that ever lived, but he that is least in the kingdom of God is greater than him. Because the least in the kingdom of God, baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, has an unlimited authority that has never existed in the context of humanity up until this time. And you're worried about your finances, and you're worried about what? The Lord says, take no thought. And actually, the word actually says, don't be concerned. Huh? Which I think is a little bit easier for us to navigate around, huh? Because how do you take no thought? How do you take that out of it? Don't be concerned about it. Don't be concerned about what you shall eat or what you shall wear. Huh? Go after the realms of the kingdom. Go after the realms of the kingdom. Hear God say, go after the realms of the kingdom. Those of you that aren't used to be around me, I'm always interpreting tongues. Oh, we have a school of the Spirit this Friday. Yeah. You can come and learn about how to walk under that inspiration. It's just as easy as breathing. Gifts of the Spirit is easy as walking around in any other reflux that you have. People make them hard. They're not hard, it's just, you know, the bottom line of it is usually when I talk about flowing in gifts of the Spirit, I'm telling people what's keeping them from flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. things that are hindering them, things that are preventing that flow from going on, because it should be just a continuous, ongoing flow. Jesus says to a woman, talk about disqualified, right? Married five times, living in adultery, said, if you just recognize who I am. All you got to do tonight is recognize who Jesus is and the gift that God brings, and you get everything God has. The only thing that's different about my children, Ruthie Anna right here, is from the time she was a baby, I told her, you can do anything. There is no limitation. Though you can do anything beyond the constraints of men's maximums. For with God, nothing is impossible. He's given you all authority. Now are you sons, and sons, heirs of God. Come on. Listen, look at that. Having received sonship. Huh? He sent his spirit. I'm not living under fear. Can you recognize fear? Can you recognize all the children of fear, all the byproducts of fear? Intimidation, insecurity, inferior, all the ends. He's not giving you the spirit of bondage to fear, to live under that oppression, that yoke, something I'm beaten down under. God has given us the authority of sonship. He sees us in a heavenly realm. Might somebody say, well, I want to see your citizenship. It's in heaven. When the People's Republic of China Secret Service was chasing down Brother Yun, they said, who are you? I'm a heavenly man. Where are you from? Heaven. Because that's the home mentality of the northern region of China, where many of the great Holy Ghost people come from. I'm even central. They're in Henan, which is the Galilee of China. The heavenly people. That's us. My citizenship is in heaven. My conversation is heaven. My mentality, the framework of what I cannot do and what I can do is in heaven. Speak the word only, I walk on the water too. I'll be the master of all the physical realm as well. So, oh God, I mean the moving of the Holy Ghost that gives to us this place where the Lord is bewildered that we don't command the wind and the waves as well. Why are you afraid? What's wrong with you people? How long do I got to put up with you? You're stuck in an earthy realm. You don't recognize who's around. Huh? You don't recognize who's in this place with you. I created it all. It was formed by my hands and by my words. It came into existence. And I put my word in your mouth. People, just think about this. It was the highest status of a prophet. Most prophets had the word of God revealed to them. The highest status of the prophet, as it was realized in the prophet Jeremiah, I put my word in your mouth. Ooh. God says to us, Romans chapter 10, I put my word in your mouth and in your heart. Hallelujah. Even the word of faith. Come on. Scratch your way out of whatever thing you in, man, and get over into what God has given to you. And I got a better way. Begin to praise Him in thanksgiving and shout the shout. And what's happened is you, with praise and thanksgiving and shouting the shout, you're going to be transfigured. See, it's a realm of prayer. It's a realm of prayer with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. It's not a realm of prayer of all prayer and supplication in some religious mental ascent. It's a realm of prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. It is a place where Jesus is praying in the mount. And what happened? And suddenly he was transfigured before them. What's going on? He's seeing now, even though he's in an earthly realm, he's seeing now completely in a heavenly dimension. Do you believe that you can go there? I can go there. I can go there because I have access. I've been seated in the heavenly realm. I have access to Him by the Spirit. I've been invited into the Holy's Holies, and that's not some kind of religious little idea and philosophy. That's a place that I enter into by the blood of Jesus Christ that I get to live in. Hallelujah. I get to occupy my place that He has given me in Zion and sit at the table with all the mighty. You can sit with whoever you want. I'm sitting at the table with the mighty. God's invited you. You may come on in. You may receive. It's available. Anybody who believes anybody who believes. Come on. The only thing that makes you and I different from anybody else, any of the great and mighty men and deliverers, because that's how Obadiah speaks of him in Obadiah 1:21, that God has raised up in this time of an administration of grace. This has been almost 2,000 years. The only difference that makes anything that makes us different from Wigglesworth or John G. Lake or Evan Roberts or you name whoever is our willingness to grab a hold of and embrace the authority and power that's been given. You shall receive power. And I'm telling you, that is unlimited. You cannot define it to one dimension. It is unlimited, unrestrained power that belongs to the realm of the fullness of God. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And then he qualifies and said, it's the only way that you can be my witnesses. And you don't think that the Father's eyes go to and fro looking right now for people who are going to be absolutely persuaded of these things? You don't think God's eyes, lids was trying when David stood there and he looked around and everybody else was shaking in their boots and the mighty men of Israel were afraid to even look down into the valley. They didn't even want to look down there and just act like he's not even down there and just talked among themselves while Goliath was screaming out with his echoing, amplifying voice that would pierce the ears of men 2 miles away. God was looking. What are you going to do, David? David, all he needed to do is feel the anointing. I'm going to kill him. I'm going to go down there. I'm going to kill him. Who does he think he is? Railing against the Almighty God. I'm going to kill him. And then Saul finds out he's going to go down there. Well, you're the only guy who's willing. So he gives him his armor. And he's like, he takes off the armor. And everybody's like bowing their heads and embarrassed. And now we're going to really look all like fools today because that little shepherd boy is going to go down there. Ooh, tasina ekipa, a shepherd. Ah, we know you. We know your heart. We know the pride of your heart. We know how you always trying to be the center of attention. That's his brothers putting that stuff on him. Huh? We know you think you're so important around here. You ain't nothing but a baby. Go home to daddy. Go back to the sheep. Trying to impose upon him some other identity. He knew who he was. He was anointed king of Israel, whether anybody else knew it or not. Hallelujah. Huh? Come on. He was anointed of the Holy Ghost to do great exploits. Father's eyes go to and fro. He's looking. Father is the husbandman that's waiting for a precious fruit of the earth. He's cultivating. Paul says we are laborers together with the Lord of his husbandry. We understand his husbandry. We understand that he is the husbandman. Christ Jesus is the vine. We are the branches. He is laboring to bring forth the fruit. If he comes as the early and the latter rain, the sovereign movings of God, as Hosea said in 6:3, Hosea 6:3, and he finds us laboring together with him, we're saying we are the mighty men of the kingdom of God, not of Israel. We will do these things, and nothing will stop us. We'll make nations our disciples. The uttermost parts of the earth are our possession, and nothing going to stand in our way. No devil from hell can stop me. Every voice will be silenced by my word of authority. Because I am in Christ Jesus, and he is in me. Father God Almighty lives in this place here. It's a different realm. Because now everything's going to challenge that. Everything that you're going to come up against tomorrow is going to challenge that. Everything that Satan's going, oh, no, you're not going to mess with my realm. And he's going to dangle the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life. He's going to dangle the subtle things of his evil, deceptive power to try to allure you away. You better be in the midst of the cloud of his glory. You better be walking in the midst of the fire of the Holy Ghost. You better be filled up with a glory realm that gives you wisdom and insight and discernment. I'm not interested in all these words of knowledge that people throw out. I'm interested in the word of knowledge that shows us everything Amen. Satan is doing before he ever does it. I'm interested in the wisdom to defeat him at every point, to be manifested to destroy the works of the devil, that no power of hell will be able to lift his face. Listen, the powerlessness of the church is exemplified by the murderous destruction of 62 million unborn babies.
It just shows just the powerlessness of the church. And I can go on and on and on. Where the church is supposed to be the hinderer of iniquity, we hinder nothing. Because we play in religious games. And we've not stepped into the relationship that Jesus died and rose again for. We've never taken the place of authority. Not corporately, individually. There's been 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of spotty different people. Start moving in the gifts of the Spirit. And as soon as they got a little bit of an edge on them, because they've been hid away in God, and things have been beginning to develop in their lives and relationship with the Lord, they get on TBN and it's all stripped off of them. They got a new hairdo, new set of clothes, new car, and it's gone. It's dulled. It doesn't advance. And then they live the rest of their existence out of something that they begin to press into, but they never went on to know Him. We're just going to have to stop making merchandise out of the gospel. We're going to have to understand there's a whole lot more than being on somebody's television program, having some kind of, you know, look, I'm going to tell you right now. I was talking to a man of God on the phone today, and this is the first situation he's going through. And I said, listen, man, the bottom line of it is, you have to understand there's a price to pay to speak God's word without compromise. And that's going to be rejection by everybody around you. But what's going to come, ultimately, even your family, your friends, much more the people that don't know the Lord. Listen, the bottom line of it is, there's going to come a day. That the day always comes. It's just that what happens, many are called, but few are chosen, because they just drop off right, left, and center. Because they come under the influence of all these other, you know, cares and issues and affairs and things that press against our soul. They don't understand that fundamentally, there is a realm that the power of God must be executed in our life. And it's right here in the thought realm. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. And it literally, the Greek language would say, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or natural, but they are God power. Yeah. To pull down strongholds. To bring into captivity every thought, every imagination, every logic, every logical question, every logical issue, to bring it all into captivity, to bring it all into submission to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. What is the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ? The knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, you can do all things. Yes. So Christ just strengthens you. The knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, anyone who believes, they'll do these works and greater works. Amen. Than these.
That's right.
All creation groans and travails waiting to see those people who are going to function with a liberating anointing.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's 4 billion people waiting to receive the gospel right now. And the only reason that they're on hold and waiting is because we've not stepped into sonship authority as God has purposed for us to walk in. Now, what's going to make the difference? All that's going to make the difference is that you begin to enter into this battle. You begin to enter into this wrestling. You begin to enter into this place of divine power and authority. Why do you say it's wrestling? Because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, because there is going to be an opposition. There's things that are coming out to stop you. Little things that have been very personal, that have been very individual, that's been all about you, have been able to take you out in the realms of temptation and trial and examination and evaluation. What's going to happen to you now when you're standing for a nation? What's going to happen to you when you're standing for your family? What's going to happen to you when you're standing for a people group? What's going to happen when you stand for a community? What's going to happen when you stand for a region, a state, a nation, nations? You're going to have to be fit to the battle. You're going to have to be prepared unto every good work. Hallelujah. Listen. Everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as pure as he is pure. God has called us to be holy even as he is holy. He's called us to perfect holiness in the fear of God. He's called us to walk even as he walks. We have to embrace the reality, be perfect even as our Father in heaven is perfect. Then we come to this, once again, to this point, we're going, how is it even possible? Be filled with the Spirit. Be filled. Both today, but not today. I've given you all that you have need of, everything that pertains to life and godliness. Every man, no one is without the ability. It's just that we choose that we're going to live an earthly life in the confines and the realms of our own earthly thinking. What happens if you start walking by the Word?
Amen.
What happens if you start walking by the Word? Most of the things that your five senses tell you is not true. In fact, it's already proven in academics that most people, what they perceive, is not accurate. So we should all be accustomed to that. And don't feel too intimidated that you're dumb. Because we all are pretty thick-tongued. You know what I'm saying? Don't feel that you're dumb.
Listen, because God gives you opportunity to be brilliant. He gives you opportunity to walk in the mind of God himself. I mean, that's brilliant. You can't be smarter than how smart God is. The mind of Christ, the mind of the Holy Ghost, the wisdom, the insight, the Word of God that gives us wisdom, that gives us insight, that gives us understanding, that gives us the knowledge of the Holy. Well, then all of a sudden, I don't care how wicked the king is or how wicked the world is or how wicked the empire is. Or Nebuchadnezzar is an example. They have the ability to recognize somebody who's got the Spirit of the living God in them. And the person who's got the Spirit of the living God is going to change the whole nation, going to change the world. Ooh, is that going to be you? How about a whole company? I was laboring in prayer not too long ago, and the Spirit of the Lord says, I'm raising up an army of mighty ones. And not a few, but many, a great company. So I'm going to be a few. There's people that are getting an appetite. They're hungry and thirsty. They're tired of the status quo. They're tired of the governmental machine. I'm going to tell you, come on. It's like Bernie Sanders looks better than the governmental machine. You know what I'm saying? I mean, Donald Trump, I mean, looks better than the governmental machine. People are getting tired. People are getting tired of the governmental machine, the same-o, while people are talking about all this stuff and nothing's happening. They're doing nothing. They're making it worse. Surprise. All they can do is make things worse. There's nobody who can cure anything, only Jesus. The only power and the authority of change is the Word of God. Only the anointing can break the yoke. He sends forth his word and heals and creates and changes. He put his word in my mouth. So he said to that girl with Lyme's disease, I command you in the name of Jesus, be healed. And I looked at her, I said, you feel different? I command you to feel different. Yeah, I feel different. She just got her test results back and all everything is zero. Yeah. And she texted Margaret and said, I'm healed. Jesus healed me. I'm healed of an incurable disease. Somebody's going to be, I'm hidden him. Somebody said, how can you do that? Just be hidden Jesus. Just right now, be hidden Jesus and go conquer the world without any ambition. Just think about it. Just be hidden Jesus and go take authority over everything. Because you're in him and he's in you and he has authority over everything. Just go around and tell everybody, you're in charge. You're the boss now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus rose from the dead, seated upon high, and anointed every one of us to be in charge. Whoever will, he anointed us with the Holy Ghost and fire. We can step into a realm, as Paul said, to know the love of Christ, to be strengthened by the Spirit in our inner being. Ooh, that we may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. And in that place and in that realm and in that consciousness and in that atmosphere and in that interaction and in that glorious relationship, be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him who is able to do super abundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to this power that's right now abiding, right here on the inside of me, gushes out of me like a wellspring, comes up, flows out of me like rivers of living water. The issues of God Almighty, his authority, his power, his ability, his divine mandates in the earth. Come on, man. Come on. Hallelujah. This is true. I'm known of so many different people. I mean, myself included. And, you know, the Lord gave us little tokens along the way. We prayed for so many people and nobody got healed. But we didn't stop because the Word said, pray for them. You in charge, pray for them. You lay your hands on that sick. And if you don't make a redefine it, if you don't make something else out of it than what I've declared, you step into it, man. You step into it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to go to a place and minister. David Hogan's going to be at it, and he's going to minister on Friday night, Saturday morning, that I'm going to minister Sunday night, Sunday morning. And David Hogan stepped into how many people has he raised from the dead? Their ministry has raised
The ministry's raised a huge number of people from the dead. He just stepped into a place. I mean, Joel Stockstill, who was here two Sundays ago, he gave his life to the Lord, got baptized in the Holy Ghost in Joel's church. Of course, his dad was the preacher at the time. Larry Stockstill. And then he goes from there, goes down to Mexico, and he just steps into the life and ministry of Jesus. How? Because he said, okay, I'm going to do this. Not because there was some kind of great event that took place and special, you know, anointing service. Come on. I know some people who just got disqualified by everybody and went and did some of the greatest things on the planet. On the planet. Huh? No one really was around Carlos Anaconda that believed in Carlos when he started in 1987. He just went and did it. He's just a businessman. He was a businessman that felt the call of God upon his life, and he changed South America in a generation. Come on, man. Just great exploits and signs and wonders. It's just somebody who's going to step into it, who's going to get bold and radical about it, who's just going to do it, who's not going to back down. See, fear. Well, what if I pray for him and nothing happens? Or, you know, man, if I pray for him and say in the name of Jesus and then I'm going to disqualify Jesus, I promise you, you will not hurt Jesus' reputation. One iota. I promise you. His reputation will remain completely intact. But if you begin to move in God, what's going to happen? Listen, Father's eyes go to and fro. He's looking for somebody who's going to risk everything. He's going to look at you and he goes, look at him. Look at her. I mean, these guys, they're going after it. They don't have hardly enough power to measure on a blip meter, but to look at them. Anoint them. Anoint them. Why? Father wants laborers. This is braver laborers. Ask the Lord of the harvest to send forth laborers. Hey, man, just raise. If you're a laborer, raise your hand. And if you're not raising your hand, go ahead and raise it now. Because you can be a laborer right now. You just say, I'm going to be a laborer. I'm hit. I'm going to do this thing. And who's the laborer? Jesus is the laborer. And he shows us how to enter in to the Father's harvest. It's about time people grab a hold of the authority and the power that is only possible because you're going to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You're going to be willing to be continually filled with the Spirit because that's where you're strengthened now with the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. So you may be able to deal with every opposition of spiritual wickedness so that you aren't going to be ignorant to Satan's devices so that all of a sudden, you know what? Satan and everything he's saying, you get to kind of put it on the radio, reach over and turn him off. You know what? Everything you say, you just shut it down. It becomes static noise, background noise at best. Huh? And you get to the point we just laugh at him. I'm taking you out. Get ready. I'm coming down to you. I'm taking your head off your shoulders. Hallelujah. You know, and you look at it. You look at people in the natural. You just look at what people have done in the areas of finance, in the areas, every area of sports, athletics, academics, on and on. What people have done within the framework of just human, as it were, demands. Just the will of man. Yeah. I used to know this little guy, real little skinny guy, and he would arm wrestle these big, huge football players with arms bigger than his legs. And he'd take them down. And everybody's just wondering, how do you do that? He'd say, well, it's not here, it's here. There's just people who, they're born with that. They understand it more than other people, just kind of naturally born with it. Just in a natural realm. What happens when you step over in the faith realm? Right. What happens when you step over in the spirit realm? Right. What happens? Now, all of a sudden, all these obstacles that exist for everybody else, they don't exist for you.
That's right.
Because you're living by the word. You're not living by the force of the human will, which is strong, which is powerful, which has been shown over and over again in the Napoleons and other, in you know, people that we can talk about throughout history who's been able to dominate the whole earth. Think about it. What made them different from any other man? What made them different from any other human being? Eh? The strength of men's own human will. Yeah. What happens when we grab a hold of the will of the Father?
Come on.
Just hear it. Just hear it, because what's going to happen? His Father's going to raise up mighty ministries out of this place. I'm going to tell you right now, out of this place is going to go forth some of the most intense, radical,
last days ministries. The Paul, I mean, rather, Daniel, looking into the future by the Spirit of the Lord, saw our day. He said, in the last day, those who know their God will be strong and will do exploits. And he's talking about sonship exploits on every dimension. There will be no sickness nor disease that be able to stand against us. There will be a day that we'll walk in to Riley Hospital. Rady Hospital. And every one of those babies with neurotube defect, every one of those babies that born with various different genetic diseases, all healed. He'll just walk by him.
Amen.
I've been practicing with my shadow for a while. Hallelujah. Paul, the Jude said, build up yourself in your most holy faith. Make yourself strong in your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. I had some preachers over at the ranch one night, and I said, yeah, I have this new missions plan for Saudi Arabia. And they said, wow. And one of them had been in a lot of different places with me. I said, yeah, you want to hear it? They said, yeah. I said, well, I'm going to get translated into Mecca on Ramadan. And I'm going to take the mic and start talking about Jesus. And when they come to grab me, I'm going to disappear. Because Jesus disappeared all the time. He disappeared many times. When you pass through their hands, he disappeared. When a Jew grabs a hold of you, he's got you. I'll tell you right now. Especially a Haredim. And you done something in the temple, you ain't getting away. I guarantee you. And they got you by their teeth, too. Hand and teeth. I mean, somebody's got you with their hands, their teeth, and their legs. You're not getting away, right? He passed through their hands. He disappeared. And then about, you know, I'll give them 5-10 minutes, try to regroup what was that. Then I'll reappear. And ain't nobody going to touch me when I reappear the second time. Yeah. They're going to let me speak. Amen. And everybody's going to get saved.
Amen.
And they're going, wow, that's intense. You know, everybody's looking at you. Wow. Yeah, dreamer. Yeah, sure, I'm a big dreamer. You know, but I'm like, no. I practice translation. You do? Yeah. How do you do that? Would you like to see me practice translation? And they're both. There's this guy. One guy's Assembly of God pastor for about 40 years. He's sitting there going, you know, and the other guy, he knows me. He's like, okay, here we go. Get ready. Okay. And so all I did, begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. I said, be ready, get ready, because the atmosphere is about ready to change. I mean, I'm telling you right now. It's going, transfiguration's getting ready to come into the room. What happens when you start believing this stuff? What happens when this becomes reality to you, not some game, not something far off, not something that somebody else is going to have some other day, maybe at some other time? Oh, I wish I was them. I don't wish I was Elijah. I'm glad I'm me. I'm in Christ Jesus. I'm the person I'm interested in being like is Jesus. I wish I was like, I wish I was Moses. I wish I was. Gee, come on. I don't even have to wish I was. I am in Christ Jesus. He sent me. Now, what happens when we start doing this? What happens when all of a sudden we hear Paul say in Ephesians chapter 4, and when he says that we should come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man? You go, that's what I'm going to do. Yeah, me too. Yeah, I mean, come on, get a roar going. Next time, wait for next time. Next time, it's the moment for a roar. You need to you got to catch that with your spirit, because otherwise you're just going to go back to mowing lawns, fixing sinks, huh?
Yeah.
And burping babies, huh? That's all you're going to do. That's what pediatricians do, you know that? They burp babies. Prestigious job. Change the diapers. No, the nurses do that. They just come in and look at them, yeah, burp them, change the diapers. They're fine. I mean, you're just going to have to get, because Paul gave it, the only alternative Paul gave, that's verse 13, chapter 4, the only alternative he gave, be babes.
Yep.
Be babies, yep. Constantly being tricked by men, living from one crisis to the next.
Yep.
What a life. Give me a break, man. Constantly thinking that you're going to vote a president in office is going to take care of you. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, if that's your hopes, you didn't need to tell you right now. Just end it all. Because I'm telling you right now, it ain't going to work out. It ain't going to work out. It's not going to work out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I heard some economists going, we can't even imagine how this fiat system is even being able to be held together right now because of us, because of the church. Father's just holding it together until we properly position to receive a transference of wealth.
Yeah. Oh.
So I know that. So I'm in it. I'm positioned. Because you're not going to do anything without faith. If you can't see into the future, the Holy Ghost is going to show us in the future. All you got to do is be filled with the Spirit. He's going to lead you. He's going to guide you. He's going to show you. He's going to take everything that Father has and he's going to transmit it, transfer it, reveal it, disclose it to you. This is who we are. Bone of his bones, flesh of his flesh, filled with the Spirit. Bone of his bones. I'm going to tell you right now. Somebody said, Mark, you just always taking the scriptures to extreme. Well, you know what? It is a viable option. Hallelujah. It's on the table. Yeah, hallelujah. You can take it to the absolute minimum. I'm going to take it to the absolute maximum. I'm going to go with Jesus. I'm going to follow him. Hallelujah. God has always stood me up with excitement about everybody who's done anything in God. Everybody knows the fun begins in the book of Acts. Give me a break. Hallelujah. I know lamentation for me. Hallelujah. I'm in the book of Acts. I'm not in the book of lamentations. And I'm not going to the book of lamentations. Hallelujah. Praise God. What book do you live in? Hallelujah. Whose word do you live by? Huh? Whose spirit do you live by? Whose insights do you make your decisions through? God has given us spiritual principles and spiritual laws. If we'll obey them, we can now walk in his word. We can live in his insights. We can make our decisions by his perception. He knows exactly what's going on. You and I will fail over and again if we try to call it and say, well, I believe that it was this. Huh? Father's going to get it every time. Absolutely right. Tonight, I want you to step into a place of consecration to the Lord, this place of sanctification. We were sanctified, set apart by God to live in the Holy Ghost, to walk in obedience. That's what the Word of God says over and again. That is what sanctification is. Set apart. To live in the Holy Ghost and walk in obedience. Set apart to live the life of Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit. You can say it both ways. That's the definition of sanctification. This is all Father's idea. He's looking for you and I to buy fully into everything that he's doing. And then all of a sudden our communion, our fellowship becomes different. Our yieldedness to him. As we begin to respond to him out of the love that he fills us with, there is no intimidation anymore. There's no sense of separation. There's no sense of shame or distance or otherness anymore. There's a oneness. There's a fellowship of divine glory. If you begin to pray and you just don't feel accepted in the beloved, that's the first place to start. I'm going to help you here. Just ask him to wash you in his precious blood and cleanse you from all sin, and you won't have a stain of sin left upon you. Amen. Just ask him, say, Lord, I just thank you that you purchased for me white robes, fine white linen. And I thank you, Lord, that you come and you dress me up and you put a crown of righteousness upon my head. Hallelujah. And that you've anointed me with the oil of the Holy Ghost. And not just an anointing like Samuel anointed David with the horn of oil and oil poured down upon him, but you literally baptized me, immersed me in the Holy Ghost. And you just begin to praise him and you begin to thank him. You understand the power and the authority that was released in Daniel's life, because three times a day he would kneel down and he would begin to give thanks. He wouldn't say, oh God, we're still stuck over here in Babylon and they treat us bad and, you know, they treat us like dirt and we're just wondering why on earth we haven't got to go home and we can't sing the sweet songs. And he thanks unto the Lord. Praise God. People, it's time to get out of your realm and his. Out of your life into his life. He's going to give us an abundant life. It's a different life. It's another life. It's not the life you were born with. The ruler of the Jew, Nicodemus, came to Jesus by night and says, Rabbi, master, teacher, we know that you are sent from God, for no man could do these works unless God be with him. He immediately responded, thank you, Nicodemus. I was hoping that somebody in the Sanhedrin was on my side. I'm just so blessed, you know, that you formed me and that you recognized who I am. He immediately said, you cannot come into this room. Ah, you can't know anything about the kingdom of God until you're born again. To receive the life of God. If there's anything, Kelly, listen, if there's anything that the churches have got to hear as you run with the word of God, they've got to hear the gospel. Receive the life of Jesus. Because everybody's got this make-believe Christianity. Receive the life of Jesus to convince people that they can step into the very life of God, that they can begin to walk in the very authority and the very power, the quality of life and the quantity of life, where nothing is impossible, where everything that Father has is available to Him. He owns everything, the cattle on a thousand hills, all of it's His. His hands have made them. Then you're going to look at your checkbook. And your checkbook's going to tell you something different. And you're going to look at the little caste system that you live under, where the boss says you can make between 20 and 35,000. You can't even live on that. And people have to do that. And there's other people that you can make between. There's people. So God's people. I'm not talking about anybody. I'm talking about God's people. So marginalized. They listen to that nonsense. It's one thing to start there and say, you know what, I'll just take anything. But I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not coming to that. I'll be in charge of all this. Amen. Hope you're looking for another job, because I'm soon to have yours. It's just telling that. It's a different mindset. It just works. It works. It works even in the human realm. How much more does it work in the divine realm? Hallelujah. T-t-p-d. Hasta-tun-a-mesh. Hallelujah. You know, my heart goes out to like the people in Ferguson. They are being stirred up and they're believing a lie that's being told to them by people who's taken advantage of them. And literally, they are locking themselves into a prison and they're throwing away the key by believing the things that they believe. They don't understand. They've now come under the stronghold of a mindset. And now all of that action, all that reaction, now they live in an oppressed mentality. I'm an oppressed person. We oppressed people. Nonsense. I watch it over and again. Jonathan, I watch it over and again. You listen to me. Watch it over and again. I look at people come from Ethiopia, and they're successful. Come from South Africa. So successful. They're just as black as you are, man. So totally successful. Because they're not oppressed. I don't feel like I'm somehow oppressed. And I can go on and on. One situation after the other. Look at the Chinese people, by and large. They never let anybody oppress them because they always thought themselves superior. They always thought we were a bunch of dogs anyways. You know what I'm saying? Hey, where's Veronica? They're there. They just always thought we were just a bunch of pagans. You know, we don't know anything. A bunch of stupid white people. Hey? They didn't pay no attention. And they just prospered. They didn't live in an oppressed mentality. Nobody oppressing them. Who's oppressing you? Who's holding you down, beating you down? What intimidation, what lie, what fear are you living under? Why don't you understand that you can break off that yoke and believe something else about yourself? Why don't you just understand that you can now, you have power. God gave you power to deal with every thought. You cannot be passive with it. I watch over and again where people are passive with the thoughts that enter in their mind. You rise up and you get radical. That's why I'm always trying to get people to get radical. I want you to be responsive. Because if you don't get radical with it, if you remain passive, that thing's going to take control of you. It's going to take control of you. It's going to determine what your will is going to do. It's going to make decisions for you, and you're not even conscious of it. Because you let some aggravating, intimidating, harassing thought occupy your mind, and you did not meet it with the authority of the Word of God. And make it obey. You're self-obeying to only believe what Christ Jesus said. That's the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. To only believe those things that God has said about His Son. Which is what He said about you and me. Hallelujah. People, let me just tell you. All you have to do is just walk in this. All you have to do is just embrace this. Is there going to be a battle? Is there going to be a fight? Yes, it's a good fight. this is what it's about. If the church is militant, I believe that some people say the church is not yet triumphant, it's militant. I believe the church is both militant and triumphant right now. I can understand why theologians say the church is not triumphant because of the way we've been acting. Okay, but we nonetheless, we are triumphant, hallelujah, in Christ Jesus. They just don't understand that, and we don't understand that. We understand it only in part. You know why? Because we're not fully living out the way Father wants us to. But if we'll tomorrow, if we'll just meet all the challenges and all the things that says we're not and we can't and we are, we got to be this and we can't do that, if we just eliminate them.
Amen.
You say, you when you begin to think and believe like God says, and this foul stuff comes along, you smash it. I'm killing you. The sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit. With all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Take into yourself the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That's not for buttering your bread for breakfast. That's for taking heads. That's for killing stuff. And it's these thoughts, it's these harassing, lying, tormenting, imprisoning thoughts that would confine you to make you believe this is what you've got to do. Everybody starts someplace. The problem is that when you begin to live in the prison, in a prison, in the place where you're in, and you're confining yourself there, and you see no way out, based on experience and based upon circumstances and all that men say. But when you begin to look at the good word of God, you say, wait a minute. Hey, listen, I've got the title deed to it all. It's all mine. I own it. Why? Because I'm in Christ Jesus and he owns it. Don't you tell me it's yours. It's God's.
Amen.
And just, you know, I'm going to be gracious and let you have it for right now. But when the Lord hath need of it. I mean, kind of thing. Huh? Go tell him to loose the donkey, I have need of it. It's his. He didn't pay for it. He didn't need to pay for it. It was already his. Go loose the donkey. Tell the master has need of it.
That's right.
The master has need of it. It's his. Anything that's out there is his.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. I'm not just looking for an experience and an event. I'm talking about a lifestyle where it grows and it continues to increase and it's magnified and it's amplified, where we live it and we're partakers of the fruit, where we walk around with the grape juice dripping off our beard because we're eating of the good things of the land of God. Hallelujah. Where we're sitting at the table of the Lord, feasting on all those things which he has supplied for us generously out of his great love for us.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'm not falling out to the devil's camp, and you won't fall out to the devil's camp either when you're so well provided for in Father's house. People only fall out to the devil's camp because they've never seen the provision. They've never known the provision. Their eyes and their heart have been blinded to all that Father's done for them. They never set up at the table. Time to sit up at the table. Because when you start eating and fellowshipping with the Father, and to receiving of all the bounty that he has supplied and did it just for you, and he's looking at you with loving eyes and says, son, it's all yours. Daughter, it's all yours. It's yours for you. Do with it. What should we do? Tell me. What should we do about the situation in the United States of America? What should we do about the way finances are going on in the United States of America? And you already engaged. Faith has already been built up. You've already confronted the bear. You confronted the lion. You've already confronted all the adversity that comes at you to try to make you fearful. And all you did was get more bold. All you did was become more ferocious. You were unaffected by it. When the harassing thoughts came at you, you began to worship God and thank him that he gave you all things freely to enjoy. How much more shall he now also by him also give us all things freely to? Hallelujah. Supplied all my needs according to his riches and glory. How that we now triumph in Christ Jesus. How that we more than conquerors. How that we the overcomers because he's living on the inside of me. And greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Thus it makes me the overcomer and qualifies me to be everything God desired and described to the churches. In Revelation 2 and 3. I'm not trembling about that. I'm in him. To be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is by the law, but the righteousness which is by Christ Jesus, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Ha! Hallelujah. That is a boldness. That is a mindset. That is a consciousness that is constantly being threatened, constantly the accuser and the slanderer is trying to subdue.
Yep.
And you and I are going to have to understand how to be fit.
Yes.
And equipped. That's why Jesus said, pray lest you enter into temptation.
Yes.
No temptation is coming against you except for what's common in a man. Father will make a way of escape, but pray so that you don't enter into temptation. And it's not any kind of prayer. It's prayer with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. It's praying in the Holy Ghost, building yourself up, getting strong, hallelujah, in your most holy faith, hallelujah, keeping yourself over here in the love of God. Because anybody dwells in the love of God, guess what? They dwell in the fullness of God. They dwell in God. Anybody dwells in the love of God, guess what? Perfect love casts out all fear. I'm going to tell you right now, fear hath torment, and that's a place of bondage. But Father has put forth His Spirit, the Spirit of the Son, into our heart where we say, God Almighty's my dad. Who's your dad? Hallelujah. God Isaiah. Hallelujah. God Almighty's my dad. Who's yours? Woo! Praise the name of Jesus. Everybody stand with me. Woo! Woo! Yeah! Yes! Musa Brakalobosotea! Hallelujah! Woo! Hallelujah! 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 Hallelujah. 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 When the threat comes, when the adversary comes, when the accuser comes, just dance and sing. Just go ahead and begin to speak in tongues and interpretation of tongues. Begin to prophesy the word of God over yourself. Hallelujah. Begin to declare the good things of God. That's what the mighty men do. You shall find me in the place of rejoicing. You shall find me in the place of those who have strength. Hallelujah. I pray in the name of Jesus that you come to understand that the name of the Lord is a high tower. The righteous always run in there, and they are safe. Woo-hoo! Threatening circumstances, situations, opposing things against your physical body. It's time to walk in divine health, people. It's time to face the battle of whatever virus takes you out every season or whatever it is, and to say, I'm not having it. 20 years ago, over 20 years ago, I said, I'm never throwing up again. Father, this is the worst thing. I feel like I'm dying every time it happens. I can't take it anymore. And in the name of Jesus, it's never happened again. It's never happened again. Because I got sick and tired of that bodily function that I didn't believe should exist physiologically in my life. Hallelujah. I mean, we just get that way. We just kind of place, I'm not going to be subdued. I'm not going to be walked over. I'm not going to do what all the things around me is trying to make me do. I'm going to stay over here in this place, caught up in heaven. You might try to pull me down to earth, but I'm going to stay caught up in heaven. I'm going to stay seated with Him. You might say, oh, you don't have any power. I'm walk over on the authority which Christ Jesus gave me. And we don't need anybody to pat us on the back and say, yeah, you're doing good. We don't need the praises and the approval of men. When we've already got the approval of God, when we've already got the honor of the Lord, when we already got His word, we got a great company of witnesses, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You don't need anybody else to validate you when you take a hold of the Word of God and you do it His way. The only thing you need is people that love you, that can look in places in your life that are wrong, that is keeping you from all the blessings of God, that will correct you and say, no, don't do that. Get back out of here. If you do that, if you think that way, if you live that way, you're never going to have these things that God has for you. I want you to get excited about God. I want you to learn how to
rejoice in Him. I want you to learn how to dance it. I want you to learn how to enjoy Him. Hallelujah. I want you to understand that the Father is so desperate about you coming to understand how you can step into His manifest presence no matter where you're at and be overwhelmed by His anointing and begin to enjoy that no matter where you're at, in your living room, in your bedroom, in your kitchen, in your car, no matter where you're at the workplace, you can just become so overwhelmed by His glory. And because when you find that, you're going to enjoy that so much and it's going to become more important to you than anything else in life. And you're going to go running to that. It's not going to be a place that's taxing your time and all these things, taxing my time. I got to do this and I got to do that and I got to sweep the floor and I got to pray. It's a place of glory, of refuge, a place that you run to with excitement and celebration. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I commission you in the name of Jesus Christ. I commission you by the authority of the living God to take a hold of the power and to take a hold of the authority that has been given to you as a son, a one who's been born of the Spirit, born again, one who's been made a new creation, made anew in Him, filled with His life and filled with the Spirit, to walk in authority and walk in power. Don't be timid. Don't tiptoe around about it. You know, I remember the first time that I was just praying for somebody. Just praying. Oh, Lord, do this, do that. And the Spirit of the Lord said to me, no, you command it. You speak with authority. And when we begin to do that, we know we're in charge. In Christ Jesus' stead, I command you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You command things around you. You command situation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You command those things which would oppose you and others around you. God sends you to. Hallelujah. This is the absolute disposition of people who are going to walk in signs and wonders and miracles and do exploits. There can be no other. There can't be any other disposition. There can be no wiggle room here. It is being sold out to these things once again in this place that we deliver to you. And I'll just tell you, I am so blessed tonight that by and large, every person in this place that belongs to this ministry, by and large, you have been completely all in with God the Holy Ghost in this place tonight, as much as you know. And I'm telling you, that is a blessing because then I get to go ahead and deliver the message God gave me. Yeah. All I do. You know, Father predetermines things for us. But if we're not willing to cooperate with Him and obey Him, He can't deliver it. He can't bring us into it because He's not going to... defy our will. But when we meet Him, He's got a predetermined plan and purpose for our life. And I'm telling you, this is the atmosphere of revival. These are the atmosphere of great exploits right here for you to do, for everybody to do, where it isn't about, you know, the individual personalities. It's about the body of Christ functioning under the authority of the Holy Ghost, not outside. I mean, we're not about attracting attention to ourselves. We're about being immersed and such a glory that nobody really can see us because the glory is too thick. That's what we're about. And there are laws to that. And the Lord's taught me those laws. And I'm desperate for them. And thus, in knowing those things that we're desperate for, when you get desperate for something, when you're hungry for it, you'll have it at any cost. It doesn't matter what it costs you. Anything that's in the way, you're going to get out of the way. You listen to me. That's the heart and passion of the Father. That's the thing that every one of us need to be bought in on. And then that way we're so happy when something's corrected and some issues dealt with because we recognize, man, we're all in on this thing. We want the result that God demands. And it's Father's way. People think that there's many ways that lead to God. There's not. There's one way, by the Holy Ghost, through Christ Jesus. And that is very exact. It is a very narrow way. It is very strict. People think, oh no, it's broad. It is not. It's very exact. It's very strict. And if we're willing to learn it, and we're willing to walk in it, then everything that belongs to the kingdom of God will be ours. And if we, and it can't happen any other way, because otherwise we'll violate the holy and the sacred things of God. It cannot be any other way. You listen to me. You study the ark and you're going to die, Azusa. You come in and you begin to try to do it your way, and you'll die as the two sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu. And I can go on and on. You challenge that which God has anointed and placed in position, and the earth will open you up, open up and swallow you, and you'll fall straight. You'll fall down alive into hell to die in the flames of fire. I mean, I'll go on and on and on. You lie to the Holy Ghost, you fall down dead. About a gift, about giving. Strict. It's narrow. Straight is the gate. Narrow is the way. Agonized to enter therein. That's what Jesus said. And you know what? I'm telling you right now. That's what we are about. The abiding place, full gospel ministry is about that. That's what we're about. You know, maybe other people can exist for other reasons and have other latitude. I can't. We can't. Because God gave this candlestick, this ministry, this anointing, this purpose, this in this point of time, for this season, for this generation, to do something very specific. And people, and there'll be people, they just don't understand it. What's going on there? We just don't understand it. Why is it so intense? Why is it so intense? Why are the songs intense? Why are the songs long? Why is the preaching intense? Why are the services long? Because there's a call. There's an intense call. There's a signs and wonders, great exploits, moving it on a scale that goes beyond what was happening with William Branham and touches more into the realms of what was happening with Jesus Christ, and then goes beyond that into a greater works dimension. And it's strict, and it's narrow, and we got to be all in, and we got to say, here am I, O God, shine the floodlight of heaven upon my soul. Whatever needs to be corrected, whatever needs to be adjusted, whatever needs to be changed. If there's anything in my life in which I'm going to draw attention to myself, or I'm going to do it my own way, I know that that has got to be eliminated from the equation before ever you're going to be able to move fully through my life, because you're sharing your glory with nobody. And your purpose to bring honor and glory to your only begotten Son, Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. Ooh, shiara batadeya. Ooh, shiara batadeya, bodadah. And I'm all in. We're all in. We're all in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're all in. You see, Caleb, there's nothing greater that you can do with your life. Because at your age right now, 15, you can begin to set your heart on God and seek God. Evan Roberts began to seek the Lord about your age. He heard all of these people around him talk about these great moves of God. He said, what do I got to do to be in the move of God? And the preachers around him just said, you got to be all in. You got to be in all the meetings. You got to be hungry. You got to learn how to get into prayer and everything they understood. And all he did was respond and said, that's what I want. You just open up your heart to God and say, that's all I want. And then you got to be faced with challenges. Your generation has to be faced with challenges and immorality, just like Sodom and Gomorrah, that most people in here never had to even go through. But if you can so fix your heart upon heaven to recognize that Father will unleash through your life all the divine glory of His person, man, what greater thing can you live for than such exploits? To be able to go visit heaven, a woman, she went through a great trial of losing 6 children. Her name was Mariah Whitheader. She believes she lost 6 children because God called her to preach, and she said she couldn't because she was a woman. Because during her day, women couldn't preach. You just Jezebel coming and going.
and then the scriptures would line up. Finally, she responded to the call of God and began to preach. Some people of the Spirit recognized F.F. Bosworth, others recognized her and come alongside of her because of the great exploits that God began to do in her life. God gave her visiting rights to go visit her 6 children in heaven. But can it be again? Look, I'm going to tell you right now, Mother Etter, as she was called, would have taken some of you women tonight and just hung you out on the clothesline. Read her writings. Because you talk about the consecration to holiness. She was everything that people in our generation make fun of and talk about, oh, the holiness about clothes. She was holiness about clothes, holiness about her hair, holiness about everything. If you put, I mean, it was intense. People would not even abide by it now. But look where she walked. I'm not saying that you had to do everything that she did. But look, everybody around her said, there's nobody who does exploits like Mariah would with Etter. And she was contemporary with Wigglesworth and John G. Lake and F.F. Bosworth and all these other great guys that we read about, great champions of faith, and nobody functioned in the anointing like she did. You know, where such great miracles, like she takes up a baby that's blind and deaf and mentally, mentally deranged in every way and paralyzed. Takes the baby up in her arms. Sets the baby down, the baby's totally healed. Sight, hearing, can speak because the baby was mute. Of a normal mind, can paralyzed and now can walk. Well, I would say I'm going to imitate that.
Yes.
But just think about it. You think about how, if you think about, if you were on the front end of her ministry before the signs and the wonders started happening, she didn't have big crowds because she was so holiness. And people would listen in 1930s to holiness preaching more than they're going to listen to it now. Oh, shikanama. No worldliness, no look of worldliness. I mean, it's just intense stuff. She'd be very happy with my wife in Geneva. She might have something to say about the watches and the rings. I'm just telling you, they're holiness people. That's just the way it is. It's just the way it is. And you may say, well, that's unnecessary. It may be. Maybe. I don't know. I know that they had the goods and we don't. That's all I know. They had the goods that we play patty cake religion about and pretend to have. Come on now. And so it's just like, okay, well, Lord, strengthen the floodlight of heaven upon our hearts and upon our souls. And really, the point I'm making is how much are you willing to be corrected? How much are you willing to be conformed? What is it that you're not willing? Well, you know why not? I'm just not willing to do that. I just don't believe that. Well, that maybe that's the point. That you're just shut down. You say, you know what? I'm not willing to sell out that much. There's a price to pay, dear people. And I'm talking to you about you coming before the throne of grace with a hungry, desperate heart saying, Father, I want to be conformed to the image of the Son. I want to be everything that you want me to be. I want to live fully for you. And it's hard, Caleb, and everybody that's in here that's 15 and 16, 14 and 15 and 16, and even in elementary school, Joshie's age, and the things, all these kids are running around with iPads and iPhones, and there's no blocks on them, and they're wide open, and everybody's showing anything and everything, and it is absolutely horrific. The exposure. And it's all the more where, you know, you guys, your children, have to be continually in Holy Ghost meetings. And your heart's got to be fixed and set upon, this is what I want, this is my goal. Whew. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just let Father put his finger on anything. You know, I was so blessed. Allie came running over to me on Sunday after the Sunday morning meeting, and she was just over there flowing in the Holy Ghost. And I was so blessed by how she was ministering to the people. She comes running to car and she says, do you see anything in me that needs to change? And I, of course, I respond to her, you know that I tell you. And, you know, I'm just so blessed because she's really let me read her the Riot Act a couple of times. Because I don't, anytime I see anything, it's not personal preference. I live by the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
Anything I see that is a possibility of opening a door to the realms of Satan, I come at it. I'm going to shut it down. I don't care what it costs me. It doesn't matter if you don't like me or not. I'm not here for ratings. I'm not interested in whether or not I'm the finest, happiest, nicest, well-adjusted pastor. It doesn't matter, man. I'm gonna lay it out there. I'm gonna move as slowly and as rapidly as the Lord dictates. But if you just, you personally, you come to the Lord in your relationship with the Lord and say, Lord, shine a floodlight upon heaven. I mean, I was prophesying the other night in my house and I was telling, because I got to get with the power of God. I'm like, honey, we got to get right with God. Because the Spirit of the Lord come upon me, the fear of the Lord will overwhelm me. And I'll begin to see myself standing before the presence of the Lord, before a holy God who hates diverse weights and measures, who's called us to such a holy calling. Sometimes it just hits me so strong. And she said, well, baby, is there anything I'm doing you want to change? What we got to do? I don't know, but let's get it done. Yeah. Father, let your glory reveal whatever, Father. Shine your glory upon our lives. Whatever you would speak, whatever you would say. I want you to live in it. There is a Holy Ghost conviction that must be allowed to once again work in our lives. Listen to me. Because when it worked in the lives of the church in former days, people's sin was so exceedingly sinful that they shook under the presence of God, recognizing that they were worthy of death. And in that response, fled from the wrath that is to come by crying out, Jesus, save me. We don't see that. People are into, he's going to help me get rich. He's going to make me happy. I'm going to feel good. Tingle, tingle, you know, chill bump, giggle, giggle. In all the great revivals, Holy Ghost conviction fell in such a way that people's sin became exceedingly sinful and they wanted to turn from their wickedness. See, that's the Holy Ghost convincing and reproving. And we're going to have to understand that by and large, we have run interference with that because we've not been willing to be corrected. Because you've got all these big ministries that are qualified based upon how many numbers they have, and they're just basically people have been raised on motivational speakers that have confirmed sin. And now that it has given momentum, as it were, to a spirit of rebellion and defiance. And who are you to be a dad to me? Who are you to be a father to me? Who are you to be a watchman in my life? Who are you to be the voice of God speaking and correcting and instructing me? I'm anointed of God. That's who I am. And so all those men who are like me. But all those men in the past, they wandered in caves and in dens of whom this world was not worthy of. They were sawn in two. They were stoned. They were beaten. Why? Because they came to the people of God and showed them their sin and their transgression, telling them to turn back to God. And nothing's ever changed. The spirit of man is the same. Now, here's where you and I have to understand and how to benefit. What spirit am I of? Would I be one who would stone the prophets? Because Jesus talked about them. Would I be one that would resist the Holy Ghost? Because Jesus and Paul talked about them. Would I fit in the category of those who are absolutely convinced that I know the ways of God and that I'm right with God so that I would look at Jesus and say, you're possessed of a devil? Because those spirits have not changed and they still remain in the house of God. They still try to work their things in the house of God. And it's time that we understand that we must rise up in the authority of the Lord and begin to deal with those things that would stop us and hinder us. And the only way that we're ever going to be fit and equipped for this battle is to understand how to be filled with the Spirit, how to live by the Word of God, how to pray with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost, how to walk this thing out and put on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. Ha. Hastikaramea Shia. Hastapakanea. Istivanamea. Some people, you may not understand what I said when I was crying out saying, we got to get right with God. I was, you know, say, well, you feel you're not right with God? I'm right with God. I was talking with reference and making sure that everything is holy even as He is holy. Because it's what He demands. God said to Abraham, He said, I am Yehovah. I am God. I am El Shaddai, or God Almighty. And I like to translate it just El Shaddai. I am Yehovah El Shaddai. Walk before me and be perfect. Jesus said, be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Peter said, be holy for He is holy. Paul said, as you have received the Lord Jesus Christ, so walk in Him. Oh, what a privilege, what an honor. That's not works. People, that's not some poor beggar's lifestyle, some cramped, you know, rigid religious living. Oh, this is abundant life, and we're just asking you. We're not asking you to change the way that you dress. I'm not asking you about that. I'm just hitting on some of the things, just talking about people who've done great exploits and where they came from, and just in dealing with the issues of where we're willing to go, where we're not willing to go, what reproof we're willing to hear, and what we're not willing to hear. Just making some points. Don't misunderstand me. Hear the big picture. What God's called us to do, what He's called us to be, what He's called us to believe. Because I'll tell you, that's right now. That's one thing that was common with all of these men and women of God. They became fully empowered because they were willing to believe what the Lord said. Hallelujah. You believe tonight. If there's anyone here tonight that you've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the miracle of salvation has never happened in your life, don't walk out of here into eternity without Jesus. You must do something with Jesus. You must deal with who He is. You must be willing to either accept Him or reject Him, because there's no neutrality. And I pray in the name of Jesus there will not be one person under the sound of my voice tonight, whether you're in here, on the web, watching by YouTube, that would reject Christ Jesus. You can't ever get yourself good enough to begin with Him. You're never going to be properly positioned to say, I'm ready now to turn my life over Him. You just call upon His name and He'll come deliver you from all the things that stop you and prevent you. That's all you have the strength to do. You don't have the strength or the power or the ability to get yourself right or to get yourself to a certain place where you're ready. Listen to me right now. Listen to me right now. All you have the ability to do is call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's ability enough, because then God will come and deliver you, and you'll suddenly see that there was never would have ever been another way out. Don't walk out of here. Don't walk out of the sound of my voice into eternity without Jesus. When He's right here begging you to come, pleading with you to come, He stands at the door of your heart knocking. He simply says, if any man will open their heart, anybody will just say yes to me, I will come in. And I will fellowship with him. And what a fellowship. Oh, what fellowship. Oh, what joy divine. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, what blessedness with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on Jesus. I'm living in Jesus. I'm safe and secure from all alarm. Sing it, I'm living. Oh, I'm living in Jesus. I'm living in Jesus. Living in the everlasting life.
Oh, I'm living in Jesus. I'm living in Jesus. I'm safe and secure from all alarms. I'm living in Jesus. In Jesus, I'm living in the everlasting life. What a blessed, what a joy divine, living in the everlasting life. Oh, what a fellowship, what a joy divine, living in the everlasting life. I am living in Jesus. Safe and secure from all alarms. I am living in Jesus. Go ahead, sing. Living in the everlasting life. Living in the everlasting life. Go ahead, sing, Chrissy.
No, I just felt like there are some of us, possibly in this place, that have allowed ourselves, especially in the area of the spiritual gifts, to be deterred and disappointed, and maybe even gone as far as to take offense by the husbandman doing his job. We start out as an eager young vine, and we're very eager, and we want to see fruit, and we're like concentrating on the bud, and we're like, come on, bring out some fruit. And then the fruit comes, you know, you start to see it, and you get really excited about it. And then something happens, and whether it's, you know, whether you had a word of knowledge and, you know, no one answered, or if, you know, you got correction for it and the fruit got pinched off, you know, it gets pinched off, and it's like, nope, that's not quite ready. And, you know, but we have to remember that the you know, a lot of times the first season of fruit, the first round of fruit isn't really fit for eating, you know, it's not ready. The tree, the vine isn't ready to bring forth full fruit that the Father is looking for. So like, we just have to remember, you know, we have to be willing to go through the pinching process. We have to have those subpar fruits, you know, taken off of us so that we can focus, so the energy from the vine can focus and strengthen us. Because the Father can't bring forth the fruit on the weak branch because it'll break.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know a whole lot about trees and stuff. But like, I know that, like, you know, we have a cherry tree in the back that's been growing wild, and we got some cherries off of it, and they look great, and we're like, oh, cool, cherries, you know, for nothing. But they taste terrible. They taste terrible. They're horrible. You know, I don't know what we have to do to them, but, you know, we have to fertilize, and we're going to have to pluck them off, and we're going to have to, you know, do stuff with them to make sure that the fruit is ripe and that the tree is strong enough to bear the weight of the fruit that the Father is looking for.
That's right. Papa says, if you bring forth fruit, I mean, you get to learn a lot about trees just because of what he said. Coming and abiding in them. You bear forth fruit. Father will then come and prune it. He'll purge it. He'll purge it. In other words, he'll trim it way back so it can bring forth more fruit.
But we have to be willing.
Yes.
We can't be protective. We can't be protective of our buds.
No, but
we have to be willing. Twist them off. Chuck them out of here.
We have to be willing to be a student in the school of the Spirit. Just be willing to be a student and not be threatened by the fact that, you know, and we allow teachers in the natural to correct us. We allow them to grade our papers and tell us and show us where we're wrong. And yeah, it hurts when you don't make an A, you made a C, or even worse, a D. But if you really are going to say, instead of being defeated, you just simply step up and say, no, I want to get this right. You don't quit. You don't quit. You say, I want to get this right. Say, I want to get this right. Let me tell you something. Here's what I heard in the Spirit and saw in the Spirit tonight. When I was talking to you about this realm of fully buying into this power and authority that is giving, being excited in an unlimited realm of knowing that God has given you authority to the point where you can begin to, as I was describing, imagine yourself being translated into Mecca. And understanding that you have the privilege now to begin to access all these realms of the Spirit. And you begin to get carried away in these things. This is where there begins to be a greater release and flow of the power of God. Because all the intimidation and the restriction and the sense of failure and not able and not having the ability, all of it's removed out of the way. Because from the beginning, it's not because of any works of righteousness which we have done, but because of His great love wherewith He loved us. And at the end, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? If God spared not His Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all, how much more shall He now freely give us all things by Him, now that we've been made who we are in Him? If you just grab a hold of this and live here, I'm going to tell you right now, the fruit will come forth in great abundance in a supernatural way. Hallelujah. Can anyone can anyone interpret?
Thank you, mighty God. Jess, it's not by coincidence that you're in the abiding place. The Lord has called you by name to be a part of this ministry. And there's a fight for your life, and you've been going through a battle, but the battle is the Lord's. It's not your battle. In Psalm 36:7, he declares, and this just isn't for Jess, this is for the entire church, but Jess, he's talking to you, and he says, how excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children, Jess of men, put their trust in the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them the drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life, and thy light shall we see light. O, continue thy loving kindness unto them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart. Let not the foot of pride come against me, and let not the hand of the wicked remove me. They are workers of iniquity. There are the workers of iniquity fallen. They are cast down, and they shall not be able to rise. Just now is your time in the Lord. Now is your time to be victorious in this battle and do the things of God that He's called you to do, to prophesy, to do signs and wonders, to do great things in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah.
Listen, amen. Listen, what I want you to understand is, and I'm asakia kadukanaya, and I'm akia shamana, and the debesatai, and I'm again the moral sitinala, and I'm akia and the mototoshi, and I'm asaperinaya, I'm beganasatia. As the Spirit of the Lord would begin to speak through us with tongues, diverse tongues that are to be interpreted, He would cause you to be quickened by His Spirit with the word from heaven. It's almost as though that it works like this. That as that tarana makisha karana motopra patoya kirishti pirinaka goes forth, it's like prophecy begins to spring up on the inside of you. Suddenly you're quickened. So it's a wellspring. You hear it on such an intensity, it's got to come busting up out of you. And so we want you to begin to give yourself it's not a mental thing. It isn't a mental thing. But you have to be in the realms of the Holy Ghost to understand. And that's why we want you. This is why you have to understand, God gives us the ability to recognize where you're at. It isn't for intimidation. It isn't for, you know, anything. It's just to say, look, this is what it is. And this is what God wants it to be. And so we encourage you and we minister to you to come over more into what Father wants it to be, where you know how to just be over in this realm of the Holy Ghost, on a continual basis. And it's, I'm going to tell you right now, it ain't going to start on a continual basis. It is going to be more in the area, on the level of your being willing to give yourself to this place, and then it becomes continual. And so we're wanting to help you, because we want the fire of God to hit you when we're doing the, moving in the gifts of the Spirit. Because if you're willing, you can hear every word. I could do a phrase, you would do a phrase. And you would just be, would be obvious to you. And then that is like the beginning, as it were. And then you also able then to begin to profit when miracles are being worked or gifts of healing are going forth. Because as you're touched by it, here, baby, as you're touched by it, and as you begin to be impacted by it in the realms of the Spirit, now you are now equipped and built up now to function in a greater dimension of it. Because these things are brought into your life through the church. They established in your life in the church. That's why the Lord said He's placed in the church these gifts. He's placed in the church apostles. He's placed in the church prophets, teachers, working of miracles, gifts of healing. He's placed them in the church so that they may be multiplied in the church and you may be strengthened and given ability in the school of the Holy Ghost to function in them. Hallelujah. Praise God.
I'm pleading with my people. I just want to bless you. I'm pleading with my people. I just want to bless you. Remove the things in your life that would get in the way of my blessing. Ha. I don't respond to need, I respond to faith. Ha. Remove the hindrance, remove the distraction, remove the fear. Ha. Remove the fleshly things, cast them aside, because I've called you to be blessed in every area of your life. I'm pleading with you to let me bless you. I'm pleading with you. Let me bless you.
Now, I want to say, if anybody's talking to anybody right now, there's nothing more rude you can do. There's nothing more arrogant, no place that you could take up against the Holy Ghost with a greater Jezebel spirit than to do that, than to not pay attention to the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is not the author of confusion. There will not be two people speaking at once. You do not do that ever. Ever. That you never do that. Ever. There is a manifestation that goes on with those kinds of things. She speaks English well enough. There's something that's all messed up right there. That's all messed up. And I appreciate your response. Because when the Lord labors to bring something forth like that, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, Satan comes out against the voice of the prophet.
Yes.
And when people, listen, Satan will create within people's realm, you know, thinking and emotions, almost like embarrassment, as it were, when somebody's flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. That is a very weird thing. You want to shut that down, because that is a very human and almost demonic thing. It's a wall that Satan uses to keep you from flowing in the Holy Ghost. When there becomes distractions and interference of any kind, you want to shut that down. Because otherwise, you're going to get another thing instead of the thing. You cannot disrespect God the Holy Ghost. He deserves all of the attention. If you know what? If people can't hear or they don't understand the language, guess what? They're out. It ain't about that. It is about everybody who can hear this for them. Period. That's it. That's it. Do nothing to disrespect the Holy Ghost. And these are just things that every one of us have got to learn. We've got to learn the rules of the house. We've got to learn the order of the house. And so, I want you to understand, God, the Holy Ghost, wants you to step in to Takana Meshikia Katilkanaya, a manifestation of the Holy Spirit, Tibrestaporana Patela, that takes you into a whole other different dimension that isn't about stardom and showdom and you know, being somebody special. It's about letting God, the Holy Ghost, flow. Hallelujah. I am so blessed by these girls, Jacqueline, others, who've hooked up with Ruth Anna and what's going on in their lives. Okay? I want you, if you don't have the gifts of the Spirit working in your life, you better hook up with somebody who does. You need to understand how to be very comfortable and not feel awkward at all in any way when the gifts of the Spirit are going forth. Don't get embarrassed about it, because those are the things Satan tries to do to intimidate and threaten. Hallelujah. So, I mean, I really just want to emphasize what the Spirit of the Lord was saying through Ruth Anna. The Lord is pleading with us because He wants to bless us. We can't even begin to wrap our head around that, because basically our response is, well, you know, where is that a revelation? You know, how is that something we don't know? No, what we don't know are the things that are going on, the issues that we are allowing in our life that is hindering the blessing. Because Father says, I want to bless you, but you got to do this. I want to bless you, but you have to have this behavior. You have to have this attitude. You have to have this disposition. You got to be willing. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now. Understand. The one thing. Listen, understand me. Hear me. The one thing above everything else that has been a hindrance to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is these kinds of activities, these kinds of issues, responses to the anointing. Because the Holy Ghost is very, He's like a dove. He's very gentle. He's grieved, and He can be easily grieved. He wants to come and all bring all the glory of Father's splendor. But if there's any resistance, He moves right back. And where we learn how to be so sensitive to Him that we don't allow anything to mess with that realm of glory. I mean, that's why you would see people like Catherine Coleman or Oral Roberts or even Benny Hinn, especially back in the early 90s, they would say, don't stop doing what you're doing, because you're now messing with the Holy Ghost and he's not going to move. Don't grieve Him. And it would begin just to be basically a general kind of a statement, just shut everything down. We've got to learn how to be very sensitive to Him. We have to learn how to come in to, we've got to learn how to bow and get prostrate before the glory of heaven in our spirit, in our attitude, with great reverence. Grandpa and great-grandpa, they knew about this reverence. Do you know, when my grandfather and other people of that generation, before they died, you know, in that transition, about the time when, you know, I was like 16, 17 years old, they would look at the church and they go, where's the reverence at? Well, where's all the reverence gone? And though in many respects, we can look across the dynamics of the church and say, well, a lot of that was just religious. Still, it was based upon the reality of something that must exist, a great reverence and holy stillness. When God begins to speak, it's God speaking. It's God speaking. And when we begin to honor that, it is true indeed. It's God speaking. He's put his word in our mouth and in our heart. It's God speaking. It's tongues. It's God speaking. It's interpretation of God, tongues. It's God speaking. It's prophecy. It's God speaking. Then we get to inherit it because the reverence must go before our reception. Just like a consecration is absolutely essential to authority. We must have these things. We must be taught these things. We must understand we have lived in a culture where the church has been so divided and there's been everybody turning to their own way, and now God's demanding an order, and you're going to get it from me. You're going to get it from me. Ruthie, let me have the mic for over here. Basta kirinash. Amen. Basta kirinash.
As Ruth was praying in the Holy Ghost, I was hearing, do not, you know, I had my eyes closed, I wasn't looking at anybody, and I was hearing, do not resist the Holy Ghost. Do not resist the Holy Ghost. Do not resist the Holy Ghost. And then I heard the Lord clearly say that people are looking at the vessels. They're looking at the people. And they're, you know, just kind of like thinking it through in their head. God can speak through a three-year-old. He can speak through a donkey. He can speak through a rooster.
Yeah.
Do not resist
the
Holy Ghost.
I want to just stop you right here because I want to pray right now. We're going to pray. And because the demonic spirits that have tried to attack the anointing in Ruth Anna's life, we're going to shut them down right now. I'm going to shut them down. Look, they're a demonic. As soon as somebody, God begins to raise someone up with an anointing, demonic spirits will attack that anointing. And demonic spirits attack that anointing through the minds of people and the attitudes of people. And so right now, as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to join together and we're going to shut that thing down. That every foul spirit of hell that would try to come out and attack this beautiful and glorious anointing that is being expressed through Ruth Anna's life, we break it, we smash it in Jesus' name. You foul spirit of hell, I destroy you right now. I destroy you right now. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah, so go ahead. We got that done.
And then I heard that there are people in here that God is speaking to you, and He's giving you assignments and things to do. He's speaking his word to you, and it may be small. It may be a very simple little word, but fear is holding you back. It's holding you back. You're looking to yourself. You're looking to your ability. And God wants you to step out, whether it's to go pray for the sick, whether it's to step out and speak a word. You know, it may be super simple, like I said, what you're hearing, but when you step out, God makes it bigger. God makes it bigger than what it is. And don't be held back by your ability, because it's not your ability that's going to take you anywhere in the anointing of the Holy Spirit, because you can't do it. It's just yielding over to the Holy Ghost. You have no ability to lay your hands on the sick and see them healed. You have no ability to do it within yourself. But the Holy Ghost is on the inside of you, and he will perform the work. Hallelujah.
Amen. And dear people, it's so important to understand. You have to recognize there is a big difference between who you are as a person and what you know about the things of the Spirit, both in the ways of how you may allow demonic spirits to impact you. You don't want to. You don't mean it. But you don't know. You don't have a resistance to it. You don't know how. You don't even know the difference between good and evil, the right and the wrong, where their boundaries are. The same thing in the realms of the Holy Ghost. There are many things that the Holy Spirit wants to do. You don't know how to yield yourself to it. Or maybe the Holy Ghost comes and begins to move upon you, and you begin to act in an inappropriate way. And those things need to be refined. You have to come under the authority. You've got to be told, you can't do that. And this recognize, hey, you know, I can't do that. Or understand, listen, there are spiritual things that would work against you, and you've got to understand how to shut them down and not allow them.
Amen. That's right.
Eh? Because it's all about being fit and equipped to deal with the temptation, the trial, the evaluation that's coming out against you. So it isn't so much the issue, if you will, looking at a person that is demon-possessed. Ain't nobody upset about the person. We want to see the person set free. When I see people oppressed or depressed by evil spirits or responding to temptation or not knowing how to resist the devil, I'm not mad or upset at the person. It's like, don't do that. Don't respond to that thing. Because we are at war. And we're at war against those things that have held, that kept the church from moving forward. And it these things pervade and impact the church all over America. And to some places, greater degrees than others. We're going to make sure, and we do it together, we're going to make sure that any unholy thing that would try to happen in this place, whether people are aware of it or not aware of it, it just shut down. And you know, hey, wait a minute. I understand how to behave myself in the house of God. Wait a minute. I understand. I've got to be careful. I've got to be more discerning here. Hallelujah. Bokorasi kina must. Okay? Everybody understand we love you?
Yes.
Understand that?
Absolutely.
Understand that? We love you. Legiri stabanose. Maleke stiperinashi. Boro stiprengalaya. There is everything that goes on in our life, whether it's healing that we need, whether it's spiritual maturity that we need, everything is based upon our obedience. You get right with God in every way and there'll be nothing hindered from coming and being supplied to you, because God's not willing that anybody remain sick, diseased, spiritually immature, or nothing. There's things that got to be corrected. And people just need to be a little bit more wise. So I understand. All I need to get is the ability to receive what Father's trying to tell me, and my healing will flow to me.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
The needs that I have will be supplied. I don't care what dimension it is. Materially, spiritually, physically, spiritually, spiritually, in the spirit, the soul, physically or materially, in the body, in the realms of material possession, whatever it is. Do not in any way find a place just stopping off and somehow determining that, well, it wasn't God's will to give me what He's already said He would give.
Yes.
And do whatever He said He would do. Understand that there's adjustments that need to be made in our life. And Father labors to make those adjustments. And that things in this kind of heat get manifested. I would encourage you, don't move around. Don't go moving around. Don't go changing seats in the middle of the meeting. Stay where you're at. It'll help you. Because usually something strange going on. When this stuff, come on, you hear me. Let there be reverence. There be great reverence in the house of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Shabbate. Haremaneshe. Haremaneshe. No, I just keep hearing the Spirit of the Lord say over and over again, speak by my Spirit. Go ahead and speak out by my Spirit. Dasturemasateya. Go ahead and speak out by my Spirit. Because really, that's what the language of the Spirit is all about. A big part of it is learning how to speak out by the Spirit. Huh. It's also the language of spirits about thinking by the Spirit. Hallelujah. It's also the supernatural equipping where you just have, you're built up in a realm to where the things that belong to heaven function in you. It's strengthened in you. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hey, does everybody in here know what tithing is?
Yeah.
Is there anybody, I'm going to drop your hands. Is anybody in here does not know what tithing is? What is tithing? Where it comes from? How many of you here today, you think that tithing belongs to the law of Moses? It did belong to the law of Moses. So one person knows. Okay. How many of you believe that the tithing began under the administration of the law of Moses? How many believe that? That it began in the law of Moses. Okay, so now we got that all clear. Okay. It began in the area of promise. It began with Abraham. Hallelujah. And we are children of Abraham. And so the things about tithing and all that God described in tithing are pre-law. And the Lord Jesus brought them over into the New Testament. And by many proofs, we've tried to lay those things out for you. And then how many of you understand how that offerings differ from tithing? Raise your hand. Understand how offerings are. Now, how many of you don't understand how offerings differ from tithing? Anybody in here doesn't understand how offerings differ from tithing? Here's how offering is different from tithing. Tithing is that which already belongs to God. Offering is something that you give above and beyond that of your own free will to honor Him. You understand that?
Yes.
Hallelujah. And by the time an Israeli, under the law, would have given tithes and offerings, it would have amounted to probably somewhere between 40 and 50% of all that he made in income. But what happened was the person who did that became so blessed that they became so wealthy, it didn't even show up. It didn't really impact their economy. Hallelujah. And the Lord says a lot. This is the only place in the Bible where the Lord says, prove me with this. Prove me in Malachi. He says, prove me with your tithes and with your offerings and see if I won't open up the heavens and pour out more than you can receive. Now, understand, there is this place of worship and obedience and consistency and faithfulness with God in these things that result in all of the full-blown blessing that Father has for you. Did you need prayer? Okay, I was just wondering what was up. Just here, see for just a second. There is, or you can stand or just for kind of seat, have a seat. But anyway, there is a blessing of the Spirit of the Lord in obedience and faithfulness. So if you don't weary in well-doing, you shall reap if you do not faint. And there are going to be challenges, and there are going to be things that would try to stop everything that God has promised from looking like it's going to be relevant to your life. Just understand. You just worship God with the offering. The offering, not the tithe. I'll give you one more thing about the tithe and the offering. The offering was fundamentally that by which men would worship God in respect to how we would now worship Him, if you would, with songs and with singing. So you see in Leviticus, or Vayechra in the Hebrew language, which means, and He called, or God called. It means, Vayechra literally means, and the Lord called. And so it says, He called out and He said, if any man wants to come to me and get as close to me as you possibly can come, then bring an offering and stand at the door. Hallelujah. And that offering was the worship. If you want to worship me, bring the offering. And that offering represented Jesus. That offering represented the means by which we now could enter into an interaction with the Lord. Hallelujah. So I want you to understand that offering obviously goes way beyond anything that is monetized, because now the Lord is looking for something, an offering that went way beyond that, came out of the heart, is worship in by the Holy Ghost and by truth. That offering that only the Holy Ghost can produce. But it's still the offering, still has a place in a monetized way in the New Testament. And so Paul says to us, he says, come and sow. He says, if you sow sparingly, you should reap sparingly. If you sow generously, you should reap generously. God will make all grace abound unto you. And he's monetizing that. That's finances. That's the place of those things that we depend upon to live out our natural life. Does he understand that? Does everybody understand that? Unless you're a farmer. And then you still depend on finances to some degree. So I want you to just realize what Father will do through the offering. Okay? He's looking for you to let go of what you trust in. And you trust Him. And a lot of what we trust in is what we have in our bank account. We trust in that. Because it's going to make the difference of whether we have the rent or the mortgage to pay. It's going to make the difference of whether we have food or clothing, whether we're shut out in the street or we're sheltered. And we get really wrapped up in all the intimidation and fear. And so the Lord wants you to release that. He wants, because worship has to be about trust in Him. Hallelujah. Sheko namate shipiritaya. You're going someplace in God. And I'm so excited to see what that results in. Amen.
Amen.
So every time you come into the meeting, every time he's going to come to me, set your heart on worshiping the Lord in every dimension, of pressing in to take a hold of the things that he was supplying. Be willing, especially in the meeting, to be trained, to be examined, to be evaluated, to be encouraged, to be comforted, to be reproved, to be corrected, to be instructed. Hallelujah. Amen. Prosatai. Amen. Now, Father, I just thank you for the gift of the interpretation of tongues, to speak now with diverse tongues. Speak now with diverse tongues. Sikudo maki kishinakatuki, and amonjeleste, and the istaparanaya, and to be quickened and to be able to understand them in the spirit, so that you may be able to interpret also. And it's just yours. Hallelujah. 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 So just lift your hands towards heaven. And I'm going to tell you right now. I'm going to tell you, Zach, Caleb, the same thing I said to Caleb belongs to you. It was for all Calebs. Here, just come here. These things are for all Calebs. For all Calebs in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't that beautiful, Kelly? Isn't it wonderful to be able to feel it? Because when you can feel it and be sensitive to it, you can function in it. And that's all we want, is we want everybody to be able to function in it. Because Father's no respecter of persons. He wants everybody to take a hold of this power and of this authority and move in it. The Lord doesn't want anybody to be held back. He wants us to be blessed. I wish above all things that you prosper, that you be in health. And when God Father talks about prospering, that's big time prospering. I didn't know little small prospering. Father, I thank you in Jesus' name for great faith in your servant, Michael. Father, I thank you now in Jesus' name for great faith in the servant's heart, in this willing spirit. That which you can only do, and you do only by your own miraculous power, without the help of men, without their efforts, you do it, Father. And Lord, I thank you for this blessing placed upon your servant's life.
Yes.
Great faith.
Amen.
Great faith.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Great faith.
Thank you,
Jesus. Jesus. Yes. Yeah. And though the opposition be strong, and though the fight be hard at times, and though it seems like, yes, you are playing king on the mountain, and it's wrestling everything right, left, and center, God has already given you the victory, and you shall stand in the authority of his presence, and you won't be left out of any of the great things which he has. Because this is what Father has purposed to do through you. Hallelujah. And Terry too. Ha. Karamon Jeshiana Makade Eli. Ashikina Basitaranai. So be strong and very courageous.
and know that these things is what Father labors to bring to pass, what He is willed to do, and don't let your heart be discouraged, and don't let your heart be overwhelmed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But find yourself rejoicing and find yourself joying. And when the opposition seems great, dance. And when it seems like it's just too much, just dance a little harder and shout a little more. Hallelujah. And just run around a little bit and praise God for the great things which He has done. Hallelujah. 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 We'll just, amen. 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 Now, hallelujah. Kita konaki kanaki ishikataka. Kina kina kote kina kaya. Sibandalay. Sibandalaya. Geneva said that she stood over here by you and she heard in the spirit the voice of the prophet, the voice of the prophet. It belongs in the midst of the church. I don't know, did she tell you? Did you tell him?
Yeah,
well, then you must understand that then the Lord has supplied it. And you can't stop up the flow. Did you know that it takes moving in faith to move in any of the gifts of the Spirit? It takes faith.
Yes.
You're going to move in the gifts of the Holy Ghost. It takes faith. And did you know, hallelujah, that to move in faith, you're going to have to be letting God pour His love on the inside of you so you can respond to the love? Huh? Did you know that?
Yes.
God saw the Holy Ghost supernaturally supply something called love so that fear won't exist. And then you just released. You released. You don't have to be healed back. You do not have to walk under the shadows. You do not have to live in the human realm of defeat and mentality, human mentality. You can walk over into the things of the Spirit by simple obedience and surrender to the living God. By coming under the rod of divine authority. It's very difficult when people have not lived under the rod of human authority, to ever walk under the rod of divine authority. Many people have not been raised under the discipline of the loving discipline of parents to say you can do this and you can't do that. And now they come into the meeting and they come into the workplace or the church place rather, and although they may live under some authority in the workplace for money's sake, now in the church place it's more of a voluntary place, and you don't understand the parents in the house. You don't understand how to be obedient children and to respond properly to the correction of the Lord. And it is first and foremost before running the race and before moving forward. It's coming under this wonderful, protective love of God that where His rod and His staff are not threatening to you. Oh no! Here comes the shepherd with the rod and the and the staff. Run! No, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort to me. They're going to keep me from the wolf. They're going to keep me from the predator. They're going to keep me from walking my own way because I'm going to try to go over to green pastures and it's going to be worse pastures, not green pastures. Whew. Come under it. Just come under it willingly. Come under the rod. Bostekerete. Arap. Esitarana. Arat duristikin. Arat duristikinist. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Harat stikishi. Who can interpret that, what I just said? Arat susikina. Ektiranasta. Now listen to Aramosi. Because it will become as an inspiration on the inside of you. You'll hear it. I command it, says the Lord. Arat stikin in a mast. I command it, says the Lord. Ziramozidaya. Utonenekikishtikaniapa. Will just become alive on you. It'll be quickened on the inside of you. Become such a powerful word in your mouth. You blurt it out.
Just blurt it out. Hallelujah. And so you hear in this place where the gifts of the Spirit, all nine gifts of the Spirit functioning, there is no reason why you shouldn't be able to receive. You got to deal with the things that would isolate you from receiving. Huh. And I'm going to tell you right now the fix-all. You ready for the fix-all? It fixes all. Get in the love. It fixes all. Get in the love and in the problems. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Uristan. I'm just waiting on the Lord. Just see what the Lord may say to others here. To encourage you, to build you up, to show you things, adjust things in your life. So you go ahead and step in. Not be unhappy, but happy. Not be left out, but be in. You know what? The only people that are left out are the people who choose to be left out. I'm not left out. I'm right in the big middle of it all. You know why? Because I choose to be. And you know who chose for me? Father chose. And because he chose for me, my choice gets to be effective. If he had not chosen that I could be in the big middle, that I could come sit at the table, then I don't care. All that I might will would not result in anything. See this? Try this. Hallelujah. See, this is the Holy Ghost realm. This ain't religious realm. I was sitting in a prayer room one day that I'd been going to many days, years. And all of a sudden, someone come up behind me and they lifted my hands up. My hands went up for the first time without my effort and without my strength. It was a divine event. It's been happening ever since. And so I'm calling out to God right now and telling you that these things are going to be happening to you. Hallelujah. Your hands just going to go up. It's almost involuntary reaction, you know. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You and KC both. Sikan bo reshikana. Hallelujah. Bimbridisht. Ebrida. You're going to get wise in the Holy Ghost. You're going to learn how to discern. You're going to learn the difference between God's thoughts and other thoughts. And you're going to understand how to be active, aggressive. I said more than active. Aggressive to be able to deal with every thought. You're going to get so radical, you're going to get so intense, and you're going to need to emerge a holy woman of God who's radical in dealing with demon spirits and everything that opposes the life and flow of Jesus Christ. And that's what it takes, and that's what God trains up in people's lives, because somebody shows him how to discern between the good and the evil, between the light and the darkness, between the holy and the profane. And so in these last days, God said, I will raise up shepherds after my own heart that will teach my people how to discern the difference. Hallelujah. And it's by the use of God's divine word that you then begin to understand how to know the distinction between good and evil. Hallelujah. Haraboshea. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Haremongesteya. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I know it's gotten late. Boy, I tell you, Father has a word for everybody in this place. Father has a direct word. Some of you, it's going to hurt. It's hurt. It hurts to reach in and pull the thorn out. But you feel better after it's done. It's aggravating why it's sin. And when you grab a hold of it, it's like, ow, don't touch it. Leave it alone. Right? You know that? Sometimes we have to reach in and pull thorns out of people, as it were. Huh? Yeah. And then other times, the Lord just allows us to release something of the anointing. And then sometimes things happen just as it happened with you. As the word is going forth, you got hit with the anointing, and a deposit of the living God comes in your life. Well, anytime you touch by the Lord like that, something has come into you from heaven. It's supernatural. You have something that you didn't have when you walked in here. And you can walk out confidently. You may not understand it. You may not know what it is, but Father will reveal it in time, because you will see that you now have strength that you didn't have. You have ability that you didn't have. You have rest that you didn't have. You have peace that you didn't have. Before you had to analyze, you just can trust.
Before there was a mental ascent in human mentality, but now there's the mind of the Spirit, and it's a realm in which you now rise up and led in to this place by God the Holy Ghost, almost as though you just carried away by the current. Honestly, when I get in the meeting, I'm waiting for the current. Just waiting for the current. And suddenly the current comes. Sweet, sweet, sweet. Sweet, sweet. Sweet, sweet. You know, people call me up. Gertrude kept calling. Her phone come up. I answer it. Boy, I'm feeling the anointing. I don't do anything but by the anointing. I'm feeling anointing. I'm driving down the road, and I just do something else. I'll get her number. Power guy comes to me. I call her up. I said, "Here's the word of the Lord." She has the Holy Ghost breakdown, has the Holy Ghost meeting on the other side of the phone. I didn't know she was in the hospital and her husband in the ICU. I said, "Don't worry about it. You can go sleep. He's going to be fine." Yo, Paya, Yusupona. I discovered that if I start talking to people out of my own self, I'm going to mess it all up. I'm going to give them something right out of my own mind. Messes up the whole plan of God. Messes up the whole flow of the Spirit. Messes up everything that God would have done miraculously. It's just been slimed by me. Tweaked by me. I don't do anything without the anointing. And I'm telling you, you can wait on the presence. You can wait on me. And then everybody gets to benefit. Man, I call her up on the phone, I'm driving down the road. The anointing of the Holy Ghost came upon me, man. I'm telling you. Who knows? She's called me 6, 7, 8 times. I don't know. What's wrong with the pastor? Is there any love? There's lots of love here. Wait on God. I don't know what to tell you. I am nothing. I'm nothing. I'm nothing. All I can do is depend upon the Master. And the Master speaks by the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost has a manifest presence. Hallelujah. And we want you to learn this. Because it's fun. Hey? Yeah. Living in this. Hey? Fakaya pekia kataya. In the last meeting that we had in Zambia, it made the Baptists line up. The Baptists lined up. I'm ready now. This is beautiful. Baptist girls, I'm ready now. Let the power of God fall on me. Jesus. Just be hungry. Be hungry. Just be hungry. Be in expectation. Never feel left out. Always be in. You can never feel left out when you jump in the middle. Just be hungry. Just stay hungry. Be always in the middle of everything God is doing. Father's great things for you. Sibaki dabushinga. Hallelujah. Sikambra dasi. Halebo sereneya. Halebo rasibinganeya. Hallelujah. What Father's going to do in the place, what Father will do here, if you're willing to let Him, to show you how to flow in every dimension of the gifts of the Spirit. As you'll begin to cooperate, as you begin to receive more, it will elevate and it'll become more specific, it'll become more detailed, it'll become more astounding. Much of the time, it's all around based on the realms of faith, the realms of honor, yielding to servitude, submissions, all those things that belong to the realms of love. And hunger for God. Listen to me. That's why Jesus could not do many mighty works in Nazareth. It's all the realms of faith. But if something begins to happen, as people begin to allow faith to begin to work, as there honor, as there's love, I mean, as you become a part of what's going on here, you don't come here for any other reason but for these reasons that I'm describing right now. It's the only reason you come. Because you want to receive the things that we have to impart to you by the Holy Ghost. And you hungry and you thirsty. And you'll do anything. You're so hungry and you're so thirsty, you'll do anything. Anything to receive that which Papa has. Whatever it takes. And then that flow has no, it's not inhibited, it's not hindered, because you're just being willing to be obedient and submissive and cooperative and, you know, participative. It increases. I think one of the highest honors that anybody could pay is the honor that Smith Wigglesworth paid to Amy Simple McPherson. He said every time that he went to Amy Simple McPherson's church in Los Angeles, that there was the place where at the first moment, the great signs and wonders, the greatest signs and wonders would take place of any place where he administered. He would have to go other places and labor for weeks to have a fraction of what he would have there. Why? Because she set an atmosphere of the gift of faith. And she was radical about it. She set an atmosphere to where everybody just stayed in expectation, where there was a desperation for the move of God. Have this and watch what God will do through your life and do in the midst of his people here. And then watch how everybody else gets impacted by it. And watch how the people come. Well, we heard that somebody who had an incurable disease was healed over there. Watch what happens in blind. Is they, so-and-so had an incurable disease. We got to go there and spot it out. Hallelujah. And so I'm going to name that church over there Bly Full Gospel Fellowship, I think, something like that. It's called the MTC Church right now. We just go ahead and call it Bly Full Gospel. Hey?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And we're getting ready to go. And John, where is that at? Walla? Wallawa? Wallala? Wallala. Wallala. We're going to go to Wallala. We're going to go do some signs and wonders in Wallala. And we're going to get that church up and going. And it'd be Wallala Full Gospel. Hallelujah. Shikaramon Shekinah. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, I break the strongholds over that city and over that region. You foul spirit of hell that wants to dominate, we're going to come smash you. We'll wreck your influence. Amen?
Yeah.
That's what we're going to do. What are we going to do? You're going to go do it. God's going to raise up great ministries out of this place. Every one of you. I'm going to tell you right now. Every one of you. Papa's not going to leave anybody out. Huh? Some of you need more help than others. You got a problem with that? I've been in a place where I needed more help than anybody else. But you know what I did? I wanted the help.
Yes. Yeah.
I'll tell you right now, I was more messed up than any single person in this place. I was more messed up than any single person in this place. Because the things we went through, I backslid, 14 years of age, ran away from home with a bunch of hippies, never came back home. God got a hold of me and transformed my life at the age of 19 years of age. At the age of 19. I became so demon-possessed. People said it was impossible for me to be saved. I blasphemed the Holy Ghost. I was so messed up. And it's a big part of why I laid hold on God to make sure that my children were protected, that I became very ferocious against demon spirits after having been set free and delivered. Hallelujah. I know some people just think I was born speaking in tongues. And I mean, I had great experiences with God as in my life. 4 years old, 12 years old, I had great experiences with God. But because of events and things that happened, at 14 years old, I just went off the deep end. And I'm going to tell you, when I came back to God, this person who had been totally given over to demon power with long, crazy, wild, freaked out hair. I'm telling you, it was weird. I began to sob and cry and tremble and shake in the presence of the Lord. And I became so broken before him. And I was more in need of help than any single person that I've ever known. And I mean, this, of course, you know, the demonic assignment against my life, as soon as that door was open, I mean, you can't imagine. You don't want to imagine. I don't tell anybody. I'm telling you, the one thing about me is I was so desperate
to get it right. Anybody could correct me. I was corrected right, left, and center continually. And I loved it. I said, yes, bring it on. Father, I'll take it. Whatever. What do you see that I need to do now? One man of God told me, he said, I want you to wear wingtip shoes. Said, wingtip shoes and a t-shirt under your shirt. I'm just every this, like, dress me up. Tell me what to do. I'll do it. Wingtip shoes. Trade in my slippers. Wingtip shoes. Dude, I'm not kidding you. I'll do anything. What else do I need to do? Cut your hair. Cut my hair. What else do I need to do? Shut up and sit down. I got that a number of times in my life. I'm like, no problem. Father, I just want you to speak through me. I am a partaker of the chastenings of God. I've come to know the realms of the Holy Ghost. And everything that is opposed to Him, I know them. And I want to know them more. Because I'm all in on this. We want you to be all in. We hope you want to be corrected. We hope you want to be instructed in the ways of God. And nobody angry at anybody. Be ferocious about the realms of the Spirit. I mean, I had prophet after prophet prophesy over my mother that they told me about, and then over my life, up through time I was 12, especially, tell all that God would do through my life, all that God had purposed to do through my life. Then after coming back in, having surrendered my life to the Lord at the age of 19, you know, then it started up again, this thing after that thing, and then what God would do. And it just was so exciting. And then I want you to know that you're right in the big middle of everything that Satan tried to prevent, but he couldn't. I promise you. We pray in Jesus' name. You step into all the blessings of God. You don't let any enemy rob you. Not for 1 year. I got robbed for 5 years. Satan tried to kill me so many times. He made sure I got in the big middle of the biggest stuff that was going on quickly. But Father's love. Father's goodness, Father's mercy. And, you know, just honestly, you know, honestly, I was telling some of you the other day, you know, I said, look at how the Lord Jesus came to this woman who'd been married 5 times, living in adultery. I know, I'm certain that I was far worse off than her. But His love is extended to me as well. So He has extended His love to you. I don't care who you are. You can step into all the identity and all the authority and all the divine glory that belongs to the living God. Accept, receive, obey. Submit yourself. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Be taught of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Go ahead, Geneva. Amen. Well, I mean, I'm only just saying this because I want every person in this place to know that you, if you want to grow, the more you want to grow, the more, no matter what your background is or who you are, the more you want to grow, the more you're going to have to be partakers of correction, of suffering. You're going to just be willing to do it. He learned obedience by the things that you suffered. And I know no correction for the time seems joyous, but afterwards it does what? What does it do? So long as you don't rebel, it does what? Yields the peaceable fruits of righteousness. It was kind of sporadic there. Yields fruit. Amen.